the Select Board meeting of May 14, 2018. And I will remind the board that seven-ish or so, James Burdine, I believe I'm pronouncing his last name correctly, James Burdine of Stratford Regional Planning Commission will be here to just talk to us about visioning in the Village District. Aaron LaChance sent us an email this afternoon. He said he would sort of would like to hear that conversation as well. And I had also invited Jackie Schroeder, who is a new member of both the Town of Rollinsford and the Conservation Commission, just to listen in. If anything comes of any of this, she's a great marketer, PR person, so this might be somebody we might consider participating in that if it should ever come to that. So I think will be showing up as well. And George, if you could stay to listen to that part, that could be helpful just to hear what we're thinking about, because one of the important layers in any kind of, and which is what started all of this, and the visioning of the Village District, is the infrastructure. Storm drain, road, sidewalks.
Absolutely.
All right, community input. First, let me respond to you, Nancy. I think you sent an email earlier today.
Yes.
So we are, it's in process. We are awaiting that. As soon as it's available, I will actually send the Budget Committee a special email.
Okay, thank you.
As soon as the link is up so that the BC can.
Okay.
Hopefully, I know Tamara sent me a link in the over the weekend, and then almost right away she says, oh, no, that's not working. I don't have the whole thing. So I don't know what happened. So it's in process.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for asking. Any other community input? Okay, department head business.
No minutes.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Minutes. So the minutes of April 23rd, I believe that is Mike and Denise who were at that meeting.
Yes.
Any comments or questions about them? All right.
Are those the ones that we tabled from last week?
No, it's a different.
But we tabled a set though too, because it was only you and Denise. I was on vacation. It must have fallen off the agenda.
These are ones that were never on the agenda.
Oh, okay.
But it was still a set that we did last week that I wasn't here to vote on.
That's May 7th was last week, and we were all three here, except that I was on my phone.
That's right, so that's.
Yeah, no, I see it.
So the 23rd was just the, yep, and the 23rd was just the two of you.
Correct.
Yep.
So are you guys all, do you want to wait?
I did read them. I don't think I had any, I don't think there's anything that could mention changes on that one, right? So I'm okay with both, if
all right.
Mike is.
Yep.
All right, so by consensus, I think we're good with both. I do have a question, Salme. You may not have been on the computer, but I was reading them on my iPad and seeing if I did find a way where I could choose recommend. You know, in other words, where you can see if I made some things. So I left a little test thing.
Oh, okay.
So let me know if it showed up as a.
I did not go on the computer.
Good. All right. So it was late. It was like 4-ish. So I'm fine with them. My only comment was, are you able to see this?
Yeah,
so that's. So you can just let me know if that can be great. All right, so now department head business. I see George and Chief Ducharme. Emergency kind of purchase, yes.
It's for $441, but I think there's another $12 they forgot to put on it, so it's for the materials.
I'm sorry, how much is it going to be, George?
It'll probably be closer to $450 or in that ballpark.
Just make it $450 then.
That's when I can't get figures of what I'm going to need on the storm drain until I tear it apart. Not knowing what the drains are going to be, so it's probably going to be happening again when I do the other.
So it's okay to have a purchase order with an estimate. As long as it's like, you know, within sort of 5%,
okay. think they're probably running, they're probably around the same as that.
You know, then at least the board is providing authority to do that at this expense. If it comes in, you know, higher than 5%, then we'll amend it, whatever. But it, what's important is that the board gets to authorize an action before it happens. That's the piece that we get slammed on. Yeah, it's an emergency, and I understand. But that's what our auditor slams us for every year is.
No, I just wanted to check if we do what is, so.
Yeah, I mean, an emergency happens, and our public safety people, you know, you, the police, the fire, even in the purchasing policy, which we've not fully adopted, it says that, you know, you have to make emergency purchases.
I'm going to move purchase order number 1420 for catch basin frame and concrete ring for up to $450.
Second.
Any other questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Excuse me. 14. There's the end. Anything else?
This is a transit I'm looking at, so we start doing this catch basin, I mean, the culverts and stuff. We don't have a transit in the highway fund, I didn't realize that. Kind of hard not to do the work.
You're going to have to explain to me what this means.
Transit's like a laser, it's a laser transit to tell you the heights differences.
So it's a measuring tool of laser technology.
And it's.
And we do not own one.
Nope.
And you think we should?
If we're going to do pipe work, you know, culverts and anything like that, we've got to know that this height on one side of the road to the other side of the road. We don't want the pipes going backwards, so.
So how does.
There is money in the.
Be a good idea.
There is money in the equipment fund still, so that's where I was planning on taking it out of.
All right, that's where it should come from, so that's good. And there is money in there.
Yep, so.
How much?
It's.
Is there?
That one.
Do you have the.
I didn't do it, Peter, I got one here to make up.
See, the disadvantage to my not having a laptop, which at the moment I am not having, is that I can't bring up our quarter one budget, which would have that very thing.
Yeah, I've been tracking everything I spend in the budget, so.
Okay.
Keeping that, there's a significant price difference in that.
So you're looking at spending about $412?
Yep.
All right, well, I would say, you know, if you write a PO for next week.
No, I can't, you and I can improve.
Let's show this.
It doesn't have to happen today, I can wait.
Well, I mean.
You want to look at the figures first? I mean, we're not doing no public work until after this meeting.
What I recall is that you had money for drywall work, which I think you actually have done.
Yes, yeah, we have it.
For the loft, which I think you actually did last year as well. And so we still have things like the.
Fan is coming in tomorrow.
Okay, we already did the PO for the fan, we haven't paid for it yet, so we're not going to see that on the thing. And the.
Trailer.
Trailer and the box for flammables.
Yes. Yeah, we're still.
And so as long as we're, if you feel we're still in good shape, is the.
I mean, we can, I'll take another look at it and make sure.
Or when is the plan to do the culvert?
Not until after the big projects are done.
Okay.
It's not happening come on, so at least the road project's supposed to start the 4th.
Of June.
Of June. And he's hoping to get the main, for the big contract, the excavation crew in to start the other project around the same time. So we have both projects going.
Both, on both developments?
Correct.
Right. He wouldn't be doing our culvert work anyway.
No, no, but I don't want.
Did you mean the?
No, I just, when it, because he's going to be doing, he's going to be involved in all of these projects, so I didn't know when this was going to be done.
So there's a culvert on Sligo Road that we're going to do ourselves, that it's above the road, it's actually above the hot top, you're driving on it. And that one has to be dropped down, and it's got to be ditched in that area, the water, so the water runs to correct.
You could do that.
Absolutely. But we've got to know what the heights are and.
That's, so this tool is helpful for that.
All kinds of different projects, want to make sure your water's draining in the right direction when you're doing a storm drain, et cetera.
Yeah, apparently the second culvert there on Sligo Road is like you know, the river's here, and it's sort of like...
It's about 2 feet low.
Yeah, instead of, you know, this, yeah.
Yeah.
So is this a price that's contingent for a certain period of time?
Nope, I just, that's the price I came up online today when I looked at it.
And is this something that can be rented, like through Taylor Rental or something?
I don't know, I haven't been checking to that, but I can, so we got plenty of time to look at it.
How often would you use this?
Depends how many projects we do.
What kinds of, yeah.
Yeah, what kind of projects?
What kinds of projects?
If we're doing, like, I'm resetting the man, the storm drains down on Main Street because they're too low, you wanna make sure the water's running from the right directions. So you wanna take a reading on each end of it and make sure, you know, which way your water's flowing and stuff. You don't want the water to run uphill, it's not gonna work too good. So, it's, I mean, it's, can be used for many, many projects. And that's why I'm not looking to get the most expensive one, 'cause they ranged from $12,000, $15,000, $2,000, you know, so...
Are there pieces that...
That's a complete kit, right there. It's got the laser, the pole that you hold to get your measurements and all that. That's a complete kit for that place right there.
And the pieces that are likely to need replacing at any particular point?
Batteries, maybe?
Batteries.
The rechargeable batteries.
I don't know if that one's got rechargeable, but you can get rechargeable for them. You know?
Any questions?
I'm of the opinion that we hire a department has to manage their budget, so if the government thinks he has money in his budget.
You did the first...
It's a necessary piece of equipment, we should get it.
Is that it?
No.
Did you... Oh, yeah, might as well, I think the board looks ready. So you'll...
If we're gonna do that kind of work, we can say it's necessary, so...
Is it helpful?
By the time you rent it a few times, it's gonna pay for itself.
Is it helpful for anybody else, like anybody, like the fire department, the police?
Probably not the fire department, when we work with water and sewer.
Water and sewer?
Well, you know, when we set their storm drains and their culverts over, you know, it's gonna help us all.
Okay.
So...
And they don't have one?
I don't believe he does.
Okay.
Because they weren't doing the work either, they don't even have a truck, so... Okay, it's for... Northwest, Tiger Supplies. It doesn't specify shipping on here, so...
Why don't you just add like 10% or something?
Purchase order 1419, Tiger Supplies, for electronic rotary, what does that say? Laser?
Laser.
Okay, for $412.
But it may be shipping on that, so I'm not sure on the shipping.
Did we add shipping?
No.
Just add 10%, please, just to, yeah.
$450.
Yeah.
You still with this?
That should go on here.
Yeah, just...
Do you still have it?
I need that to order.
Bring it back to Carolyn. So I'm putting an estimate of $450, which includes, right?
Second, okay, any questions? All those in favor say aye.
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 Let me just get our copy back. I never know if we're gonna be leaving it to you, because I don't need to see that. Just one.
Just, also to let you know, we decided we're gonna mow the sewer plant for the, so they don't have to go and buy more.
The what?
The sewage plant.
Okay.
It takes another hour, and we can do all of our stuff in about 4 or 5 hours, so do all our mowing in one day. So we decided we're gonna do that for them, and they'll buy the gas we want them to, but... And that patch where the pipe is broke will be hopefully done next week. They get a...
So
accounts, they're getting accounts set up now to, so we can purchase product on their account, so we don't have no moving money.
So this is some, this is water?
Water and sewer.
Water, or that they're doing?
Where the water main broke, we're gonna pay for it for them.
Okay, but with their.
They're paying for the products, so we don't have to move.
Right, so I believe in one of our folders that Caroline mentioned today, there's a road work permit. I'm struggling now to remember where that is and why, but you should know about it, and you probably already do. Where somebody's, oh, it's Bluen, it's the Bluen building.
Yeah, I talked to him last week, they're gonna cut the sidewalk, about 3 feet, so they can put a conduit up the pole. And I suggested before they put a conduit up the pole, they'd probably wanna talk to Eversource to replace the pole, since State Plow took a chunk out of it, that's about half the size.
Yeah.
About four or five of them along Main Street.
But as far as the work itself, you've read it and you're okay with it?
Yeah.
Well, why don't we, so we now have a permit whenever people open and obstruct the street. We do it annually, although I'm not sure we've done it yet with the water and sewer. They have to give us a deposit, and they have to make sure that the road is back to where it was before. And that's the purpose of this particular permit. So there is $400 due, $300 is a minimum deposit, and $100 of it is non-refundable. So the $300 we'll give back to them if the road is, if you look at it and the road is fine. So because this is a permit and I'm the only one signing it, I would like a motion to put this on the floor, this permit to open and obstruct the street for whatever the company is.
Is it company?
What does it say? What does it say? Well, we need to know who we're extending it to.
Right.
So, I'm not going to sign the contractor's signatures, but we need a contractor name, in my opinion. So we'll put that back in there.
Put a little note in there saying that we do.
Yeah. Well, what you can do is, if the board is willing to sign that, we could make a motion to sign it once the contractor's name is put on that, and then what gives one of us, any one of us, the authority to sign it. So if one of you would like to make that motion.
I'll make that motion that we agree to sign the permit as soon as a person that's doing the project is identified and name put on the document.
Second.
Okay, any questions or discussions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And it can actually be any one of us, so we'll take care of that.
Motion, please.
Yes, I'm wondering about something. You may want to listen to the.
Yeah, I'm going to stick around.
Yeah, but thank you for standing. Too short.
Good evening.
Good
to see you back.
Good evening.
Hello. Oh, no. How are you? I'm also with the good news, right?
Please.
We had four of those enhanced traffic enforcement details, Bear Road, Roberts Road, Route 4 corridor, last week. And in those 16 hours, the officers made contact with over 100 vehicles for various violations.
Yeah.
So, it's a good strong start.
Yeah.
Good strong start.
That's excellent.
And now someone passed me on the right with an officer literally sitting in front of her. I'm sure she was very surprised when she got pulled over. You know, the giant signs that don't pass on the right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, we had a rough weekend with a couple of vehicles. We'll start with the 2016 Ford Explorer. Scott said it started to smell unusually funny last night on his shift. He parked it here. I started it this morning. I said, I'll get it over to Dover and see what the issue is. And none of the engine lights came on. It had a funny smell to it, but it didn't run rough until I got on the corner by Robert's home. And all of a sudden, the engine went bang, bustled the other knocks, boom, 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 and it pulled off the ramp right inside of the road when everything started leaking oil all over the place. So I suspect it was probably a blown motor. It's got 39,000 miles on it, so it is under the warranty. The warranty for that is five years or 100,000 miles for the powertrain. I say it should be under the warranty, you know, as long as Ford doesn't try to say that, you know, they found something wrong with the case.
Right.
So it was sent down there. They have not done that.
Down there?
It wasn't Ford.
Okay.
It has not
That's
been.
That's where we bought
did,
it.
Right. Well, no, we bought it at Irwin Ford.
Okay.
But Posen Ford does all the warranty work.
Okay.
They have not done a diagnostic on it as of yet, so I don't know what the final outcome will be. But as soon as I hear something, I'll be sure to forward that to you folks and then discuss more next Monday or whatever the case might be. Issue number two, Cruiser 72, the 2010 Ford Explorer. Last Thursday, it started to rev really high, going at low speeds. So it sounds like a transmission issue. That transmission, we can't check it because it doesn't have a dipstick like the other ones does. It's actually a sealed transmission. So we sent it over to Dover, and they said, well, because it has a sealed transmission in it, we really can't do anything with it either. Because it's not no longer under the warranty, I said, well, you know, who do I know that does transmission work? And that's Bill's transmission up in Rochester, and I've known Mr. Blanchett since the last 30 years anyway. So I sent it up there today. They haven't done a diagnostic on it as of yet, because I want to get the purchase order signed for the diagnostic. And once we hear what the issue is, it's one or two things. One, it's either low on oil, transmission oil, because we've never had to put any in because, again, it's a sealed unit, or two, is going to be a transmission issue. So I said, worst case scenario, what are we looking at? I said, well, worst case scenario, if we have to replace the transmission in that vehicle, you're talking about $3,000. So if that's the case, then we might want to sit around and talk about, because the plan was to get rid of the sedan this year. We may not want to spend $3,000 for a transmission in that Explorer, the 2010 Explorer. It is the oldest vehicle, even though it doesn't have as much mileage on it as the 73 being the sedan, and sell it just as it is with a bad transmission as opposed to putting $3,000 in to get rid of it another year and a half or 2 years.
How many miles?
That's got just turned 100,000 recently.
So what did we authorize this year? One or two? Did we authorize just one year?
Just one year.
Okay. So was that the one you were going to get rid of in the first
place? We're going to get rid of the sedan.
Oh, I'm sorry, you said that.
Yeah, the sedan has 140,000 on it.
Okay.
So even though it's newer than that Explorer, mm-hmm. It has more mileage. So
all right. So we'll wait until you hear more, and we'll have a discussion upon options. My question is, how are you managing with the fleet that you have?
Well, we're down the half, so what I've done is we had traffic details scheduled for this week. I canceled them for this week until I hear back from either one of the two vendors to see what the status is of those two vehicles. So we're maintaining with the two. Yeah.
The sedan and the Explorer, or do you have two Explorers?
One Explorer and one sedan.
Oh, okay.
So, is there anything that might, can anything wait until our meeting next Monday? Is everything, should we do anything now? Or?
No, I've just authorized the diagnostic on the Cruiser that's at Bill's transmission.
Yeah.
And you know, once he tells me something, I'll send an email to you folks and we can discuss it next Monday. It's either going to be one of these. One, it's going to be either they have to put some oil in it, and we're talking, you know, maybe a couple hundred dollars,
right.
Or worst case scenario, you're talking three each, so that's over $3,000.
Do you have the estimation of if it's a motor for the other one?
For time out of service, or I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, that's not
a service man just said that he would give me all the details tomorrow.
Okay.
So, yeah.
Okay.
It could be several weeks, actually.
I would assume so.
Yeah.
It's
kind
not
of
going to get one and then
exactly, yes.
So that in means, 1 week.
So.
In 1 week.
It's Monday.
Now, several weeks of no details as well.
Well, we'll do that on a case-by-case basis. You know, if we're at the same level that we are next week, we'll probably throw a couple out there.
Okay.
Anyway.
I don't know what that means. What is What are you talking about with detail? What are you talking about when you do road work?
The enforced traffic details. Plus,
that we get money for.
We, the town gets revenue.
And that we built into our, but, well, it's, we, you know, it's built into our budget. I mean, it's what you think we should consider revolving account for, which is an interesting idea.
But we actually do have a detail with EverSource this Wednesday, so we can cover that, that's all. We have, we only have, I'm gonna work it, so Lieutenant will cover the roads, there's two vehicles right there, so. Okay, purchase order number 1397, the Bill's Transmissions for one Diagnostica Cruiser number 72 for the amount of $300.
Can somebody just move that as said?
Now come out of vehicle maintenance.
I'll move purchase order number 1397, the Bill's Transmission for $300.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Thank you. Oh, you need this in that minute.
That's all I have to do.
Really?
What more can I do?
That's it? Well, son of a gun.
Anything for me?
No, we're about to talk about visioning for the Village District, you're welcome to listen if you'd like, I mean, it makes.
What is it for the village?
Well, when we invite James Burdine up here, I'll announce it and then you can just see whether it has any relevance.
Thank you.
Thank you, take care.
That mean it's my turn?
Yes, please come up. Nice to see you, James.
Good to see you.
Do I pronounce your last name correctly, is it Burdine?
It is.
Thank you.
Weird, I know.
Pardon?
It's weird, I know.
Well, it's just different, so I just, I wanted to make sure that I was correct. So James, this is the whole board, I don't know that you've met all of us, this is Denise Knowles.
Hi. Mike Rolo.
Mike Rolo. And James Burdine is from Stratford Regional Planning Commission, I don't know your official title, I'm sorry.
I am a regional economic development planner.
There you go. All right. Well, so let me set the stage as I know it to be and why I think you're here, and then we'll march on.
Okay.
So Cynthia Copeland, your former executive director, came to visit us on our farewell tour. And during part of that conversation, I said, you know, Cynthia, we're on our road plan, you know, 2020, we're gonna be doing, you know, sidewalks and roads in the village, you know, not sure exactly how best to get them aligned, or, you know, should we expand the sidewalks to make them standard? Should we get rid of them and just use the street, you know, with lines, you know, what should we do, whatever, whatever. And she looked at us and she said, well, what I would say, she says, do you have a vision for what you want to do to the Village District? And I said, no. You know, and inside though, I'm like rolling my eyeballs going, oh, because, you know, nothing is simple, and that's all. But I reflected upon it and I know she's correct. If we're going to think about the village and things to do, we need to know what the town would like with the village. Is this something that, you know, does the town want to see more economic development? Does the town want to increase pedestrian traffic? Does the town want to decrease pedestrian traffic? Whatever. That's sort of what we're talking about. So I guess what I'd like from you, and for this is just a free form conversation among the three of us, so if you just feel free with James to ask any questions. I'd like you to tell us, why is this a good idea for us to do? What is the advantage of doing this? You know, because, you know, really the initial question was infrastructure. Sewers and streets and sidewalks. So why should we have a vision for the that part of town?
Sure. So I think anytime you want to talk about putting an investment in physical infrastructure in your town's future, you really want to make sure it's the right investment. So if you're thinking about exactly what you said, how are we changing our sidewalk infrastructure, our road infrastructure, whether you're looking at water and sewer, you want to make sure that all of those things are being put in the right places and connecting to the right places. Yeah, I think I've been with SRPC for 16 months at this point, something like that. And I've been down with Colin Lentz, who's our transportation planner, about this time last year. And we were looking for, from Rollinsford and from all of the communities in our region, just sort of what projects do you have that you're working on? What kinds of things would be priorities for you? And I think the idea of connectivity in and around the village came up then, too. So it sounds like something that you've been thinking about for a bit, just in terms of how does this part of Rollinsford interact? What's important to the people that are around here, or who's trying to get from point A to point B, or even what are points A, B, and C that are important to people?
And I think at the time too, and I remember it's during the day, so I don't know, this was well over a year ago, so I don't know who else was around, but we also mentioned that, you know, of all our surrounding communities, you know, the one that seems the most logically connected to us, even though it's in a different state, is the one right across the river, South mm-hmm. Berwick. So, and that was just a comment that we had made at mm-hmm. that meeting, is that, you know, we just share a lot more with South Berwick than perhaps with the city of, like, Rochester, say, or
mm-hmm. Right. So I think in part where you are in this process sort of depends on where you are already in terms of your master plan and thinking about what you would like Rollinsford to look like in general. So I think if you have a standing big picture master plan vision, that might be a starting point. If you don't have that might be an opportunity to sort of do a larger project for Rollinsford.
We do have a master plan.
Okay.
And how can I say this in a politic way? We don't necessarily do a good job of manifesting the master plan.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm embarrassed to say that probably because, you know, it's never been online, I don't even know what it says. But I do know that something happened in the late 80s, 89 or something, some kind of overall visioning sort of thing,
mm-hmm.
and where people, the townspeople at the time, were very pleased with the sort of rural aspect of Rollinsford and that made it special. And so one interesting thing about working on the Village District is that it doesn't change that aspect mm-hmm. of, you know, the rural aspect of the town. It gives us perhaps a locus for some economic development activity mm-hmm. that we could concentrate on. You know, and I know that there are some tools that are available, whether they're TIFs or anything, new mm-hmm. things that are coming down the pike that could help. So, I mean, that's what the board will be thinking about. You know, we'll go back to see if our master plan says anything about the district. Do you happen to know, Mike?
It gets updated every, you know, so many years by the planning board. The last section we're on, space, I think. It didn't have anything to do with the Village District.
Is there anything in there about the Village District, per se?
Sure, probably.
Yeah, so you can see.
The planning board hasn't worked on that section in the last
yeah.
4 years.
So it would be nice to know what the master plan kind mm-hmm. of said, just so we're not contradicting something in the master plan. So it's like that's a place for us to start. I don't believe it is online. Am I incorrect?
Yeah.
So we could send you a copy.
Okay.
I assume you can find a copy.
So if I can, I just want to touch on something that you just mentioned. Since you are thinking about sort of people valuing rural character and the character of Rollinsford, It's not uncommon for a lot of historic small towns to have a somewhat denser community center and then have that more spread out rural area. And I think yeah, exactly what you just said with the village being sort of Rollinsford's opportunity for that economic development, if prioritizing that character is the most important thing in Rollinsford, that's probably the advice that any planner that came in would tell you, that you know, the village center is going to be your opportunity, short of developing large parcels of that undeveloped land. This is what you've got to work with, and this is probably your best asset for where to direct that development.
So James, then the tool, if the board thinks, continues to think this might be a good idea, the tool for us to find someone to help us work with the community and see how the community feels and where the community thinks we have to go, the tool to find someone or some group to do that seems to me to be an RFP, where we lay this out and ask for people to submit their ideas, proposals, and their cost budgets.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, that would definitely be the way to get somebody on board to tackle the project. I think it sounds like there might still be a little bit of work to do to flesh out exactly what the project is, where if you're thinking specifically, it sounds like it could be anything from as small as, well, we could maybe use some help figuring out our infrastructure in the village district, figuring out a circulation plan for where vehicular traffic is going to go, where we want pedestrian improvements to go, all the way up to sort of a full-scale village master plan chapter, where it might include transportation, housing, economic development, parks and public space, community facilities. And it seems like there are sort of a lot of points that you could fall at on that spectrum. In part, there are also going to be a lot of price points that you could fall at along that spectrum. You know, town resources and what you have or what you have the political support for could be part of that conversation to figure out where you fall on that spectrum.
Right. You know, and for me, the thing that always feels most comfortable, just for me, not talking to the board, is a plan that that gives us some steps to move forward. So in other words, here's the plan as we think we'd like it to be, and then it can be chunked up into pieces so that, you know, we're not spending a lot of money at one time. We can see where we're going. You know, maybe TIF is a good way to sort of move forward for some of the things. I don't know about all things, but certainly the money that, you know, it's in our 10-year road plan to work on the village. So we may need to postpone that a year or two if we're still trying to figure things out. You know, work on other roads and infrastructure in the town. You know, I don't know. And so it's hard for us to figure out exactly what that scope is just
sure.
yet. But
so would
please.
It make sense then, the first step then, being having listening sessions with the community, especially the folks that actually live in the downtown, the village district, to see what they might want, and go from there maybe?
Yeah, I think you could certainly solicit input from the community about sort of the scale and scope of a project that they could see happening. That's also going to be the first step to any project that you do.
We know we need to fix this
full outreach.
Every road in the town needs work, and we have a highway plan to do that. So we know every road in the village needs to be repaired. Every sidewalk in the village needs to be repaired, for the most part, with the exception maybe parts of Front Street. So we know the basic things like that. We know there are infrastructure needs with water and sewer in different districts, but we know that we should be working in concert with those folks as well.
Well, stormwater, which is ours.
Stormwater, which is ours, right? So we know, I think we know about some of those very basic infrastructure needs. I'm sure there's more that our consulting engineer from Boyle Tanner couldn't list. He probably had a longer list of things.
He just drove by himself.
Yes. But it's the larger vision of what people want to see, like for economic development, that I think that would be helpful to get that input from folks. And we can sit here and dream and hatch up all sorts of plans, but.
Right. So an RFP looking for a group that can help manage that, but you know, a facilitator, right? So that when we do start these listening things or bringing people in, I mean, people can structure those meetings in ways that are most helpful. I've been part of strategic planning sessions, charrettes for this, charrettes for that. You know, they can be really helpful. But what we need is help, I think, if we want to pursue this, in writing the RFP so that we know what we're asking for.
Right.
And that's where we've talked about, okay, SRPC might want to respond to this RFP, right? Because they are SRPC may have staff that would be very helpful to move this project along. But we want to make sure whoever helps us, if we also want to hire SRPC to help us write the RFP, then they have to be from like two different parts.
Right.
And we got that. Okay, you got that okay from Cynthia when she was still there, and we got that okay from the municipal association as well. So that looks to be a final approach if we want to do it. The million-dollar question, I hope it doesn't have a million-dollar answer, is roughly the help that we might need to write this RFP, which would likely go to town meeting next March. You know, the results of the RFP, not the RFP itself.
Right.
What I'm hoping is that the writing of the RFP is something that we could finance ourselves this year. But you have to give me, please, some idea.
Sure.
What?
I think how much staff time it would take would depend on who was doing it, how familiar they were with exactly what you want, how long it took, you know, meetings like this to actually work through exactly what the select board would want. I would imagine it would probably be somewhere between 20 and 60 hours of staff time. The billing rate obviously depends again on who it is, whether we change our billing rate in the next fiscal year, currently for a dues paying rate and loans for those pages to SRPC, I bill at 50 a month.
So
that would be between one-ish and three-ish $1,000.
Okay.
It would be a rough ballpark, I would think, for a consultant to draft an RFP.
Yeah. Okay. That was the answer to my million-dollar question. Thankfully, didn't have a million-dollar answer. Are there other questions about, you know, what, why we might need an RFP and help with writing the RFP? Okay. So, I think we're good. We'll think about this.
Okay.
We'll figure out how we're going to manage it, if we are going to manage it this year. The cost of the facilitator to do something like this is going to depend greatly on whatever that scope. That's
right. And I would, having just given you a general estimate for what we would charge to put an RFP together, I would really think about what processes you're using. So one resource that I brought, Plan New Hampshire does community design charrettes.
Yep.
And
I've heard of them.
This sounds like the type of thing that might actually fit very well with what they do. So for that, you wouldn't be writing an RFP for a consultant, you would be essentially using them as a consultant. they would
have. So this is an actual application form to say, can you please help us?
And they don't have deadlines, it's a rolling application. I think the standard fee for them to do a charrette is $6,000, unless you work something else out in advance. I don't know the extent to which they are willing, able, or frequently do negotiate some other expense. But they generally put their own design team together, come in and do a two-ish day visioning session, bring people together, bring local experts to talk about specific issues. So if you're thinking that you would like this to be, the overall project to be smaller than a full master plan chapter, and you just want an event that can bring people together, that might be a good option to explore as well. That's not something that you would need us to write an RFP for. Which isn't saying that we don't want your business, we would love it.
I understand that. But I know you understand too, one of our biggest constraints is the dollar sign one.
Sure.
So this will be a really good thing to read. Thank you so much for bringing it along. I forget about them occasionally. Caroline has been to some of their workshops at the Municipal Association meetings. They've done workshops.
And if you want a good local example, they just did one in Somersworth. I don't remember if it was, I think it was in 2017. They were looking at the plaza property in Somersworth, so close to the downtown where the liquor store is.
Yeah, I know exactly.
And some solutions that they could do, both in redeveloping that property and connecting it into other parts of their downtown. So I think that it could be a good option for something that you would be willing to explore if the outcome you were hoping for was a report with some ideas. If you were looking for something more official, like a master plan chapter, you may end up opting for a more intensive process, or you could do both of them and do this as sort of a way to get people interested and talking and excited about that next set of master plan updates.
Yeah, I think this is a really good idea. I think we'll take a look at this. We'll think what you just told us, and I guess we'll be in touch with next steps unless there's something else you want to ask of us, or the board wants to ask of James.
Yeah, I think on our end, if it came time to actually work on putting the project together, the questions we would be asking are probably very similar to what I've been asking tonight, is just figuring out exactly what you're hoping to get out of the end product. And I think that any consultant who would be helping you put on a public forum or anything like that would probably be asking that question as well. So think about it on your end when you're trying to decide what course is best for you.
Great. Thank you really very much, James, for coming. Appreciate it.
Thank you all.
Where are we slated for the highway fund for the village? 20 or
2020? So we've had some community folks walk in. Did you have? Can I talk to them, Aaron, before I answer?
Okay. Mine's pretty quick.
Okay, hi, how are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm well, thanks. Nice to see you, Madeline.
I was looking online, came across this thing about surveillance on the roads.
Surveillance on the roads, you mean the
traffic?
The traffic?
Yeah, and you have some kind of a grant or something, and the roads you're looking at are there. Portland, do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah,
I'm trying to think if it was an actual grant, man. I'm looking past you, sorry.
It is a grant, right?
It's a highway grant from Highway Safety. It's actually for the entire town, but
right.
we started with the Bear Road,
well, you know,
corridor, but
right.
but we intend on Penny Clement Road in Florida.
There are other roads in town.
Right, well, that's why I'm here, I'm really like
Imagine which one might be thinking.
Only because, you know, I mean, you look at Bear's a fast road, and the houses are spread out. Clement, we're tighter, and we're much more effective. We have people that walk, we have a lot of walkers. We have a lot of people with strollers. We have people who...
Ducks, wasn't there ducks, poor ducks that were...
The geese, and we have little geese, we have turkeys, we have all kinds of things going on. Now we have construction.
Yeah.
And that's dipping, that's just like coming right out with the big dump trucks, but I really would like to see Clement.
So Chief Ducharme, is it on the list?
It is.
Okay.
Yes.
So they will, we will be there at some point.
Well, I came to say.
It was wonderful to see you, Ellen.
Good to see you all, and whatever, James.
Oh, okay, good.
We're starting to box things.
And I don't know, James, I liked what he was saying about the village, it sounds very promising.
Well, you know, we've got the Blue Building that's being worked on, you know, just thinking of retail on the bottom. Well, he's thinking of retail on the bottom floor and...
He's gotta take out some floors, doesn't he?
I don't know, that's like...
So the top, was it three floors would be residential, and the bottom three, the bottom two, and then there's a basement, really, would be commercial.
So you wanna think about foot traffic?
Yeah.
Do you
really want a restaurant in there, so...
Do you wanna be a destination, can the village be some kind of a destination, or at least a place for more people to be living and creating walking traffic?
Oh, right, I know, people love that, I mean, because I'm downtown Dover, and I have to tell you, I can't tell you how many people come in and want to be walking distance to town.
Exactly.
It's the new thing.
It's the new, look at the new market, look at New Market.
New Market, that's fine, that.
Isn't that, yeah.
Yeah.
So...
But that's Chinburg.
Yeah?
It is, yeah.
That's not Chinburg, but yeah.
No, but,
you know, we're starting, if we start conversations, bring people in, bring in the townsfolk, bring in those of us, even if we don't live in town, we still are very interested.
Oh, no.
Right?
A vibrant downtown is good for all.
Yep, so...
Very good.
So that's what we're thinking of, and we like, I don't think James is gone, but, you know, we like the freebie one, or almost freebie one first. We're gonna look at Plan New Hampshire and see what they offer as far as services. Not quite free.
Well, I thought it was $6,000.
It's more expensive.
I went like, whoa.
But what he didn't mention, I was gonna ask him, I should have asked him, but you can, you don't have to pay the money out of town funds. It could be grants, other things like that, so I don't know.
Right, so...
Maybe the second conversation with him is what kind of grants
we're... Yeah, we can figure it.
Yeah.
We'll figure it out.
But if we're doing all this work in the village anyways, all the roads,
I
all that, why not?
I would be involved in the work from the village, we have a committee, so...
That would be super, and I invited Jackie Schrody, you probably don't know her, she's sitting back there. She's new to our community, works in marketing and PR and stuff, and has a lot of energy, and so if some things come about and we're going to have a committee, you know, we're going to be wanting to look for people who are really interested and try to help out, so thank you.
Right, well, thank you.
All right, see you later, Madeline.
That was pretty easy.
Thank God, she knew Sharon was still here.
Thanks,
and Lynn, did you want... Was that the same
she's
thing?
She's my partner.
No, I just
partner.
Out.
Oh.
Oh, okay.
She's my supervisor.
All right, take care.
Bye, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, so then, Aaron? Did you want to talk to us about anything, or were you just... You sent us the general services.
I could speak about a few things. I'm in no rush if the chief needs the business.
No, we've already seen
the
chief.
Is he here?
Yeah, he's outside.
Who was here?
The fire chief.
Oh, is he still here?
He's in the hallway waiting
for us. Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry what?
I didn't see you come in. Please come on up. Aaron.
I'm done, yeah. And I was just listening to the plan. How are we?
All right.
Few items of business I need to take care of. First one is with kind of a spin-off from the work they were going to do on the dam for relicensing and all that kind of stuff.
Yes.
So we delved into our water rescue equipment, and like everything else, it has a shelf life. So we've gone out and purchased some flotation devices, vests, rope bags, and we've been working on some of our training for water rescue skills. So I have one purchase order here. 1250 to landfall navigation. It's $229 and it's for, like I said, quotation vests and for rope bags.
And the duck race, you know, it doesn't encourage
a lot. Duck race, the stuff that, there's been a lot of incidents here early in the year in waterways around the seacoast. I mean, I'm sure everybody heard one in New England, you know, the guy hit the buoy. Killed his neighbor, 7-year-old daughter.
Daughter, yeah.
So there's been a handful of them, so we don't, you know, want to quit deciding to leave the duck race. Have to make a position shell park.
I'll move purchase order number 1350 to landfall navigation for sort of water rescue equipment for $289.70.
Second.
Any discussion?
No discussion.
All of the papers say aye.
Aye.
Aye. I was not able to attend the duck race this year, but I think our wranglers retrieved most of our ducks. I don't even know who won, but.
One more purchase order, $13.49 to Eastern Fire, and this is for some of the equipment for Engine 2 that we did not get when we initially got it set up. Some of the slide-out two boards that you may have saw there on the pump panel, the equipment that goes with that. And with the onboard generator, we had a new system for running electrical power inside of the building. We needed to purchase the equipment to be able to do that inside. Switch over boxes basically from the engine's power to residential power. So all the miscellaneous equipment is again through Eastern Fire. It was the same gentleman who we bought the fire truck through. He's the representative for 20. He came in and took care of all the installation of all these parts and pieces that we needed at no cost to us. The cost for all the equipment and what we needed is to come out of the vehicle repair line. It's $2,696.76.
And your line is in good shape.
And that line is. That's the first dent.
All right.
Halfway through the year.
Purchase order 1349, Eastern Fire, miscellaneous fire power electric components for $2,696.76.
Second.
Questions?
So, Mark, the, just not following, just support it, just doesn't matter. The generator. So, what is it? What is it capable of doing? It can run power for a resident if you need it?
Okay. If we had to say somebody had power out and they needed to be on O2,
okay,
and they don't have their own generator,
I got you.
We could go in and augment that for them on
portable
short term.
For short term.
Exactly.
I got you. Okay.
Exactly. Because now the onboard generator is a 10 kW. We have two 200 foot lines that will go off the side of the truck.
I got you.
So not only to run our equipment for lighting if we're inside of a building,
yeah,
if we have an incident, but also to do some,
that's
some
great
work for the residents themselves.
Sounds good. Are we ready?
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
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 Oh, you got one. That was good.
Now,
she is ready. She is ready. I'm excited.
I did not do that.
I'm
just
excited.
Came back because we had a call. Cut the calls to the bank.
Is everybody okay?
Yeah. Cut the call around the Citizens Bank. I've never done that before.
A local one?
Yeah.
I had a fire alarm in there, so we're getting the call around to look down. So, you must think we'll find the car.
Did you find any loose change here?
No. Just those will go with those to go to.
Just to go to.
To go to Caroline.
Caroline.
Yeah. Yeah, just small items that use. Takes care of the building for us.
Okay.
Those are the two items that I needed to present.
I believe that you are not on the list for the future testing at the hydro plant, so I am going to put you on the list.
But we have to have it on.
I didn't skip what I saw. I didn't see this. So I need
then
to.
I think
we need to remind him.
Okay.
Yeah, there are two Ducharme ones because he's, you know, I never know which one is the one he's going
to. So I'm on the list as what?
All right, so our hydrolyzed relicensing, we own the plant, but we lease the operation, and the new operators are now Green Mountain Power out of Vermont. And in the process of relicensing, they have to go through hoops, the likes of which. So the stakeholders are like our fishing game, Maine's fishing game, federal wildlife, all of those. So this our state, Maine, feds, all these people. And so they require the relicensing folks to answer some questions and make some studies, do some studies. So the current one was the eel survey, which they're doing in the evening, you know, with their flashlights or whatever, and they're going to do once a week.
That's a spin-off, right? Make sure we have our flotation study.
Exactly.
In case one of them doesn't.
Exactly.
Get scared by the eel.
Whatever. So they have a series of tests. They're not all at night. Some are during the day, but you know, I'm sure people are going to be walking around with like slickers or something that say, goodness knows what. So we just want the townspeople to know what's going on as well as our public people. And
yeah,
so,
I saw a lot of the emails and notifications.
Yeah, I know. I know. I forwarded to you, but then I saw something else come from their main engineer, and I didn't see you on it.
That would have came my way. Okay.
So I want to make sure you were definitely on his list. Goes to the mill, so goes to Cutter. Goes to Ducharme, it goes to us, and you know we'll host it, but it would be very nice, wouldn't it?
Although, like I said, with the previous emails and the notifications that I've gotten, that's what prompted some of the stuff that we've done.
Yeah.
And when anybody saw it the last week, they were swimming around in the water and had the flotation suits on and they were doing rescue training. So, with some of our new personnel also, so we're trying to stay in the water.
Excellent. Anything else?
I have a question. We're going to be having maybe an initiated meeting for CIP, and do you have any preference? I know it's not going to be Mondays, because it isn't for us either. It's like a Wednesday.
Yeah, no. Yeah. Okay. Usually a Wednesday.
It really will be just kind of like this is what we're looking for, the department heads as well as any other ones to get it. So as I get it set up, I'll let you know what it is.
Okay? Good. Okay. Yep, that works. I know, what, 6:30 here?
It'll be a real quick first one, and then we'll get to the nitty gritty when everyone gets their stuff together.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Aaron, did you have anything that you wanted to talk to us about with the double culvert?
Yeah, I think I had some good news.
Yeah,
so.
George, do you have a night preference for CIP? Wednesday, okay?
Yeah, no.
So we got your general services agreement. We just got it. We'll look it over. And
I didn't print a hard copy. No one uses hard copies anymore. It's all PDFs.
Yeah, it's usually the case. I'm writing these days because I've restricted mobility at the moment. But
so you get free from your computer for a little while?
For a little while.
That's nice.
I'm doing well. I'm doing things on my iPad. And I'm actually able to do Excel. I updated the CIP plan in Excel on my iPad.
Surprised. Impressive.
I was slower, but it's more manageable. I have a pinch nerve and whatever. We don't have to talk about that. So what else? So what?
I talked with our permitting person, Kimberly Peace,
yes,
and gave me some excellent information about the Sligo double culvert situation, and then looks like we're going to be able to do the replacement under what's called a routine roadway permit and shoreline PVM. So those are pretty easy forms, and they're really designed for communities to do them with their own forces, which doesn't mean that we couldn't help you with the filling them out, but it's a very simplified, streamlined process. Because it's not a prime wetland, which Toronto doesn't have any, it's, believe it or not, the maps show that this isn't tidal, which I don't believe. I know that it's tidal all the way up to the dam. Head of tide is shown as being lower than this location,
really?
Apparently. I asked her three times.
Robin seems to think that the tide comes up that far.
We know it does.
Yeah, I've seen the tide.
I'm not going to argue with
this. Underneath the dam, so I know it comes up that far. But as far as the permitting goes, it's not tidal, which is good. It makes life easier.
So if we were to look at a permit by notification that Toil Tanner did for us, like for one of our culverts in the past, we could just kind of use that as a model?
I think you could, yes. You would want to download the most recent forms because DES changes them.
I see.
General format, the descriptions, and the type of, the breadth and depth of information and responses, absolutely. The one thing that you probably still would want some help from us on would be the sizing. We can go up to a 48-inch culvert.
George, do you want to come up, George?
Up to, depending on the interpretation of what the existing culvert size is.
Yeah.
So, it's In some situations, it's a maximum of 1.5 times increase on the existing. So could we say that the existing is really the bigger stone box, maybe? You know, I think probably could say that, even though it's sort of slip-lined with a smaller pipe. But I don't envision that we would need more than a 48, but again, I haven't done the analysis on the watershed. But it looks like we can go up to a 48 and still be under these streamlined permit processes.
So, and George, you had gotten a cost on what size?
36.
So, I don't know if I'm just, are you suggesting that it would be helpful for us to have you look to provide the optimum size? Is that what you were suggesting?
Well, it's, I couldn't tell you that 36 or 48 is the right size. It would give you a certain level of performance. I can say with good judgment that a 48 would improve the situation. I don't know that it would give you 25-year performance, or it would, you know, under these events, the rubber wouldn't over top. But just engineering judgment would say that it's going to improve the situation.
Okay.
So,
that's what we're looking for.
So, but I thought you said there was some area in which you could provide.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm sorry.
So I'm not doing a hard sell on engineering, but if I was to size a culvert, I would want, you know, if I was a public works person, I would want to know what the right size is. And then you can decide, well, we really can't, you know, we can't do an 8-foot box or, you know, whatever, but we can do a 48 or 36, and we know what the cost is, and that might be a good, you know, middle-of-the-road solution. So, you know, again, as an owner, I would want to size it and figure out, you know, engineering-wise, what it would need to be. But I'm also telling you that, you know, going to 36 or 48 will, by judgment, improve the situation. So it really, it's up to the board with where you want to take this.
So the board can decide this. What would it cost us, roughly, to have a task order for you to sort of right size?
So it depends. Let's say it depends on, do you want us to do a field visit to look at the condition of the existing, or is it just a purely numerical exercise where we look at it on paper, calculate a watershed, and say there's 200 CFS coming here, and, you know, no survey, make some assumptions on slope and inverts and really broad brush, and we might be able to do that in, say, 8 hours, which, again, so for us, we're about $100 an hour average, depending on the staff mix. So maybe $800 for really bare bones, give you something, pull some printouts, you probably couldn't use it. Well, if there's permitting questions, you might be able to use that if they're related to, you know, how you sized it and came up with the methodology. Up to, say, maybe 20 hours or a little bit more to do more in depth, maybe take a quick site visit. You don't have to flag wetlands with any of these solutions, which is great. That's would be another level of having an environmental person out there and surveying them and creating a survey-based plan. So I really like the board's pleasure. What, you know,
yeah.
You can make something work with either do nothing with just some judgment that I've given you here, some minimal effort to help you size it, or something that's a little bit more involved that maybe we can help you go through the process of filling out a shoreline PBN and a routine roadway and say, okay, so the next time you have all the tools, sort of a tutorial, lots of options.
So I, you know, it's 7:30 at night. I always like to reflect on this late, you know, as things go on. But actually my first reaction is, if by judgment we know that 48-inch culvert is going to improve the situation and we can do sort of a permit by notification, part of me is thinking, oh, maybe that's just what we ought to do. That's just my first thought. I mean, I don't want to make that decision tonight. I'm just saying what I'm thinking. And I don't know, George, if you want to say something, or Mike or Denise.
No, I think increasing is definitely going to improve the process, but, you know, what is your thoughts on the road down the road? You know, if we're going to do this, we want to do it before we build the road.
This is the other case where my eyeballs are rolling
there's
inside.
There's something additional that might need to be done.
No, I mean, I'm talking about when is Sligo. I haven't seen that.
Sligo is, boy, it's late on the list.
But if you're going to put a culvert in there.
Yes, go ahead.
If you're going to put a culvert in there, we might as well do it the right way. And then when that road's ready to go over it, it's done.
So what you're saying is a rationale for maybe we should hire Oil Tanner for, you know, this sort of $800 to $1,000.
Yes, and see where we stand. I mean, it may be that it might need more.
It could. My gut feeling is that again, you would have a big improvement with the 48, but, well, I don't know, what is the goal for that section? Is the goal that it doesn't become inundated at a 25-year event, or that it makes it to 50, or 10-year?
That would eliminate every problem now, but...
No, but we, you know, if it's washing out now with just, you know, storms here and there, the road's not gonna last. So, I mean, that's the impression...
That was my understanding, was that it was a...
That I have.
Media fix and...
So... So, the road itself, and we still have the other culvert to worry about, it's on. So, but it's on the, you know, we're gonna work on the road plan that, actually, soon as we can.
Right, and I'm ready, whenever you're ready for that.
I'll send out an email to SRPC.
What's the other culvert?
The one that's now a one lane road. So it's clear, nearer to Pinch Hill?
Oh, okay.
Do you know the one I mean?
Okay, yeah.
Right before Sligo.
Yeah.
So this is the one that we're talking about right now is the one that keeps on overflowing?
That's correct.
And it has the one inside of it?
Yes.
Okay, so...
And the one on top of it.
Okay.
Yeah, I never really fully understood it until last week, when I was talking to Robin. So there's a granite box, just like the one that's further, probably as old as the one that's the one lane bridge. I mean, small, it's not quite as big, right? And at some point, someone put a culvert within that.
Mm-hmm.
Which restricted half the flow.
Yes,
right.
We don't know, nobody knows why. There it is. And then, because it still didn't work, somebody put a culvert on top of that. But that culvert is practically useless, because that's the one it's not even angled correctly. Is
and
that...
it don't work until, by the time it works,
the road is overflowed.
So, in your opinion, you're saying if we put the 48, you said?
Yes,
up to 48,
yep.
It will definitely be a much better
Much better
process,
than we have now.
And you probably won't have a road washout.
It'll handle the normal flow.
So, in my opinion, it would be that we should at least resolve this little problem, or medium problem, and getting it to work correctly, and then maybe it'll give us a year to come up to do a warrant article to do the two of them, or I don't know.
Well, so what I think what we're suggesting is going to be expensive enough such that
we wouldn't want to go back there.
Yes.
Okay.
That,
all right.
That's
no,
my thought.
Okay.
Yeah.
If I mean, but do you put a lot of engineering time and effort if we are pretty certain that it's going to solve the problem? Or I mean, that's the question, right?
I would say improve
the problem.
Yeah.
All right, that's all. Improve it. Good point.
That's just true.
Yeah. But if we don't do anything, because it's going to be a lot of money.
Then we could wash the road out and be a lot more.
And the farm. This is an important.
Yeah.
See, this issue here that we had was not caused by the tidal waters. This was caused by
a rain event.
The rain event.
And the lack of the flow going in through there.
But I've seen it with the tidal waters were high and. My first time here, I think it was a combination of both.
Yeah.
So just so the board knows, there's roughly, we sort of budgeted roughly, I think, $5,000 for engineering expenses for this year.
But do we still have to do the other culvert engineering expense?
Not this year.
Not this year.
No. We were looking at, and I spoke with Aaron last week afterwards about the second culvert. Doing it, just winding it back up, and there's a possibility that can happen, but we haven't talked any more than that.
Without using the bridge money?
Without removing what is there.
Without removing the granite culvert?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, that would be beautiful.
We avoided, the work that we did on that last time, we specifically avoided getting a wetland permit, because all of this great stuff that's with this other culvert, we have all
of
these.
We're not talking about
the southern Sligo culvert.
Yeah.
Sligo Brook. This has all the issues that this one doesn't. It definitely is tidal.
It has a historic home.
Right. It's a tier. think it's a tier two crossing, so there's Army Corps gets involved, and when Army Corps gets involved, it triggers the historic review. The historic review is going to hit them culvert, it's going to hit them home. It's going to be a lot more complicated process. So we, when we did the work before, we said, what can we do to just get the thing open again and not have to need a wetlands permit? So we didn't go out beyond the edges of the road, and we just got it open. And we said, we'll deal with that back home. Can of worms or later. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be, that's going to be more complicated.
Right.
But to get back to the northern culvert, two things. 48 might be actually too big, I don't know. So I just said that's the biggest that we can go up to under this permit category. So I threw it out there. And then the one thing that we're limited with is we can go no longer than 10-foot extension total. So 5 feet each side, 10 foot one side.
By extension beyond the road, is that?
Right. So if their desire is to, in the future condition, perhaps raise the roadway up to improve, because in some situations, the only way you're going to fix the flooding is by getting the road up, and that's with the tidal situation. When you bring the roadway up, you need a longer culvert because the new slopes come down. So knowing, you know, those are things that we won't figure out with this very limited or no investigation, is what's the optimal length for this if you wanted to, say, get the roadway above the 50-year event, which doesn't mean you couldn't extend it later, but you know, doesn't give you a long-term solution.
So did you suggest that if you did an engineering study for this, that you would think about us at some point wanting to raise the road so that when the tide does come up, it would prevent the road from flooding from the tidal waters? Is that?
We could, but that's why I asked, what's the goal for this section of roadway? Is it to have it above us, an elevation for a certain storm? You know, this gets back to, is there a, I don't want to say a roadway master plan, but when is this slated for work, and what would that level work be?
So because LIGO was really one of the last, and we had three people who were working on it. Somebody from SRPC was kind of a road guy, but not an engineer. We had Jeff, and we had Suzanne Hewitt, okay? So none of us were road engineers. So we're just looking at really road surfaces, you know, what should we do when, you know, based on the condition of the roads. And we didn't know about certain culverts in some of these. So talking about Sligo Road, there was no, other than when we did Pinch Hill, we did want to change there was a Y intersection there, and we changed it to a T. So that affected Sligo. But talking about changing the sort of topography of a road, or looking at a road for some broader re-engineering, that didn't come up when we were talking about Sligo. And driving on it, I mean, it's such a wonderful rural road, but it has, you know, has issues. I can see just from driving on it, it has issues, you know. So this is where I just get confused. I don't know what the best thing is to do. You know, I know we want to do something. If we can, you know, what's comforting, I don't know if that's what, to me, is that we can probably do it this year. You know, because we've got $10,000 in the culvert fund, which we have agency to spend. And hopefully we will have some money left over from the road service. I mean, unless there's a big overrun on that project. And between the two of them, plus we've got, you know, we can cover the engineering out of our professional services thing. So we might be able to, but, you know, I don't know what the best approach is for us to take, because I'm certainly not going to be on the board, you know, when Sligo Road comes up for a more serious discussion. I mean, the two culverts are clearly things that we have to work on.
Right.
The road itself as a, probably shouldn't be moving my arm out like that. The road itself, as an entity, and thinking about it, George?
Looking at that road more this spring, I think we can save a lot of that road by ditching properly, because right now the water's running right along the hot top and it's digging the road up. So when we get in and start ditching it, we can probably just grind and resurface that road a bit and not have to go to the major. You know, I mean, you're going to have to grind it because that road's definitely beyond.
Yeah.
I mean, you're seeing it more every day.
Yeah.
And we're patching it steady, but it does have to have some ditch work done on it, and we're going to have to start concentrating on that. But I'm trying to get through these big projects and just real work on where the water's flowing the worst and doing the damage.
You know, ordinarily, my goal is to always do the right thing. And certainly for this board and several of the boards that I've been on before this particular configuration, you know, we have seen a lot of cans, you know, around here that have been kicked in our general direction that we've been having to deal with. And so while I don't particularly want to kick a can down the road, if we can get an engineering design that just increases the flow for the road sort of as it currently exists, that may work for us.
I'm thinking down there, especially, if we can get the ditches to flow towards that culvert instead of, you know, I mean, right now it's flowing across the road, but it's not helping your roads either. So, I mean, we got several issues down here.
Yeah. And the tides, if the tide comes across it, whatever it does, and it may do so more and more.
But my question is, you say you don't do, I haven't seen driveway culverts in a lot of places in this town where the roads, you know, the water runs up to a driveway and stops. I mean, when you can ditch all you want, if it's not going to make the water go anywhere, we've got to put driveway culverts in some places. And is that going to be on the homeowner's expense?
We don't do driveway culverts. It's not the town's expense.
Right.
It's at the homeowner's expense. Now, we can talk to homeowners.
Now,
we need to look up whether we could say we have to put in a culvert, but you have to maintain it.
We can install the culverts in the driveways.
Yeah.
I think we could charge for the culvert itself. And I mean, the initial time is on the homeowner. But I'm going to use Berwick for an example. If they had a little culvert, they put one in on the driveway, and that culvert fails, and it has to be replaced, the town replaced those culverts.
Well, we have looked this up.
Because it caused an issue with the roads.
Well, we can ask the homeowner to fix the culvert, though.
Yeah.
I'll go back and look at the.
No.
But we did something wrong once, and we did fix somebody's culvert, and we shouldn't honor him. So. What I don't remember is, if we need a driveway, do you mind this conversation?
No, that's great.
So if we need a driveway culvert,
mm-hmm.
I don't know whether then it's the town's expense to put it in or not. What I do know is that the driveway culvert is the responsibility of the homeowner. Because, this is how the logic works in my own mind, that homeowner doesn't have a house, we don't need a driveway culvert. Right.
Okay.
So that culvert is there.
Because going down by the farm, I'm seeing the culverts cross the road and come back across the road, and it's the water's not getting where it should be, because of course the dishes haven't been done in quite some time. We can reroute the water, but it's still got to go by these driveways, and there's no culverts there.
I'm going to ask a really stupid question.
It's not a stupid question.
What do you mean by a culvert? Are you talking just a tube that goes under a guy's driveway?
Yes.
Okay. Did they just put one on Silver Street? Yes.
Silver Street.
Where I live, on Silver Street.
Someone did
when they were doing
hot topping,
and I
saw
where
they
put
a tube
through. Is that what you're referring to as a culvert? Okay. So, what's the advantage of the homeowner to have that?
If the water's running down the road and they have to get across the ditch to get in their driveway, there's got to be a culvert there for the water to continue to run down the side of the road instead of across the road.
Or instead of gathering
right.
in this property.
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
But if it weren't a house, all we would have to do is ditch.
Wait, all it was a ditch, and then it was this metal tube.
Right, you wouldn't be putting a piece of culvert.
You wouldn't be putting culvert.
No, I see where you're coming from.
See, the only reason there's a culvert is because there's the paving to get from the road to the thing. So it's the homeowner. If there was no house, we could just ditch.
And continue to water along the side of the road, you say.
Right.
But right now, there's no ditching, because, I mean.
Because someone needed to go the driveway from their house to the road.
Well, I mean, just going down the beginning of Sligo Road, you can see where the water's just running along the edge of the road and it's digging it up. I mean, this is 6-8 inches right against the hot dog. That road's gonna collapse if we don't start ditching it back.
So, what we need to.
But when we get to point A, where there's a driveway that needs a culvert, then we're gonna have to deal with the people.
So, what I'm unclear of, I sort of get clear in my mind that if there is a culvert that exists, you know, at a person's driveway to get, it is that property owner's responsibility to maintain it, and we can make them maintain it. What's unclear to me now is if, oh, we the town think there should be a culvert here, whose responsibility
that,
is
that's
to.
That's what my question is.
Yes,
yeah.
And it's mine as well, so I'll check in with SLGC. Municipal Association, sorry.
Because if it's causing the water not to get from point A to point B because that driveway's
right.
there now, and that culvert's bad, or there is no culvert.
Right. See now, in subdivisions or whatever, the planning board can put these provisos or conditions or whatever in place, but Sligo Road is one of the old.
And it's not just Sligo, Clement Road's the same.
Well, yeah, these are old roads.
You know, they've got the ditches, but they don't have the culverts under them,
yeah.
under the driveways. The water's
all
running
right.
off the road and it's going
so,
to their property or what have you. But.
Yeah,
let's find out. I'll ask the question. But that's driveway culverts.
Right.
So.
No, but I mean.
So George, would you feel more comfortable having engineering design to sort of size up the culvert?
That culvert, that
yes.
particular, yes.
But not necessarily for, you know, 100 years from now when there's going to be a lot more problems.
Sure. No, I would definitely rather have an engineer tell me what size we should have. And let's do it, you know.
And I think I heard Robin say that though, that she would be willing to let that granite culvert granite box
and,
go.
You know,
and if we're using it, if we can reuse
well,
it,
I would
that's
like
a lovely
to use
thing.
We're going to use the granite to make a head wall. So
that's a lovely thing to do.
You know, we're still going to make a head wall when you start it to keep the roof from collapsing.
Mm-hmm.
So.
And while you're here, let me ask this question. Because, you know, we're getting a new principal and a new SAU director, you know, in the town and whatever. And it's a goal of mine, whether it's explicit through things you've heard from me or not, I have a strong feeling of threading our community together and looking for ways to thread our community together. And if there, you know, we've got this beautiful granite culvert there. Could children go down, is there, you know, during a dry season or something, is there a way without disturbing stuff for them to look at it?
Or the southern Sligo culvert?
The big one. Yes, the southern one.
That's an interesting question.
It's just, yeah, you don't have to.
I'm thinking of, you know, me as a parent, I would definitely let my kids fall around in that, but I'm thinking of some community to the doorstep with the issues of
as a field trip with parents and appropriate personnel.
Yeah, I've been in that, and it's, you know, big enough for a grown person, but I think you have to ask, you know, I'm not the right person to ask, I think.
But no, would it damage, I guess what I'm asking, the parental and all that stuff, that would be the school district's issue, but would it be damaging for 24 kids to walk down there and just kind of look at it? It's beautiful. I mean, it's these huge granite slabs, you know, it's kind of fun to see.
Oh, absolutely, yeah, no, I mean, they were originally designed in part for cattle crossing, so there's, you know, a bunch of school kids that are going to do any worse than the cows that come through there, so I, yeah, absolutely.
Okay, that was just my question. All right, thank you. So board, any other questions of either? Where are we
going?
Here's what I think. We're going to ask Aaron to write a task order, so then we can look at the task order.
Okay, so we have a dollar amount.
Yeah, okay.
Is there a number that, so we can work within the confines of the budget that you set, and you know, if we don't use the hours or it's easier or whatever, we don't spend it, but you know, is there a number that works better or doesn't?
Well, I would love this to be as much under 3,000 as you could possibly get it to be.
Oh, I mean, we could do a lot of engineering for 3,000, so.
If you can get it under 2,000 then. Name that too, you know,
well,
name that.
Again,
name,
it's
I understand.
You want with the permit. The less we do on that end, the more that the board takes, the more we can spend on the engineering side.
You know, the truth of the matter is we have a shallow bench. I mean, that's one of our problems. And when one of us is out, to say nothing about two of us, either, you know, with, you know, family issues or medical issues, it really costs us, and it really slows our response time. So my first thought was, yeah, we'll just do the PBN permit by notice. We'll just do it ourselves. But you know what?
You have enough work on your plate.
Yeah, and who would do it? Who would we ask to do it? So
I'll take this. I'll see what a turnkey solution is, where it's, you know,
turnkey,
you do very little other
yes.
than listen to me.
We've got a great road agent, you know, George, you know, we just need to know some of the sizes and some
yeah.
of the.
Okay. I'll put one together.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Yeah, except for it'll be safe there. Okay. That'll be
good.
Safe for the
public. All right. Good. I'm glad. Makes you feel better. That
well,
makes that
no,
will make
I,
us.
And
feel
I didn't
better.
Want to. I didn't want to do it. You know. I asked the contractor what his size is. He thought the size would be, and he, you know, the 36 or better.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so we're in the.
I gut feel that's the right size, but we'll figure that out.
No, I'd rather see, you know, if we can get a 40 in there, that just eliminates it further down the road.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Super. Thank you for coming, Aaron.
Great.
George, thank you for staying.
Yep. What from SRPC? What has changed his last name?
Burdine, but it's spelled B-U-R-D-I-N. And he's their economic development guy. He's really quite wonderful and informative. You know, we had a chat one day, I don't know, just kind of an informal chat here in this room with, I think, Colin, who's also from here, but just about, I don't know what we were kicking around, and I don't know if there were other board members there, but, you know, how do we increase economic activity around here? In South Berwick, it just seems, you know, across the bridge, you know, when you're from one town to another, and that might be a, just kind of a fun way to thread those two communities together. But in some ways, you know, the size of the towns just seems, you know, we just seem more closely related than, like, you know, Somersworth, Dover, Rochester.
When you cross the bridge, you go up to the other side of the road, you notice that all of the buildings had commercial on the ground floor.
Mm-hmm.
And the residential above that was for a good reason behind that. People would want to cross.
Yeah.
Right,
mm-hmm.
From
the
side
the
of the river.
Babies, yeah.
And they utilized those stores.
Yeah.
So
well, that's the way
that's the way
towns were, right?
But we have a very shared community between South Florida.
So it's too bad we're not in the same state.
Sell more cider, pull the people over.
Right. Well, I think our economics were aided by not being part of that state. Because they were dry and we were wet.
Mm. Oh, I see.
A lot of people used to come down on the train and buy booze.
It was a lot of traffic on Washington. It was a lot of traffic on the bridge.
That's
anyway.
Right.
That's
right.
All right.
Yeah, there was what, 6'3"?
Thank you, George. Do you think sometime you could take me down there so I can understand what we're talking about?
With
a cycle? With a
culvert?
Yeah, absolutely. All right, we'll
talk.
Give me a okay. So
no,
I
absolutely.
It's
really
show you
fascinating
more.
Because
I don't want to go by myself.
I'll show
you
both of them.
I want to follow the culvert.
I didn't
walk down myself to not to this double one, but I finally realized what we were talking about, so which was helpful.
But just so you know, I did talk with Aaron about the other one.
Yeah, and
being able to do that at a lot less money than, you know, like just widening
right.
the road and another
so,
slide.
So when we come to budget time, you know, we put 10,000, we should probably put more in, but
well, that one there will be definitely a.
Yeah, I would love to keep that culvert. It's just.
And it's possible. I mean, it's lasted that long, it's not a super highway.
Yeah. Right, there is a.
It's just a matter of, you can buy the prefab concrete walls like they do for the bridges today, the nice looking blocks. Build a red head wall and put another slab on and widen that road out. Then you're gonna get your traffic flow back. And not having to worry about someone crashing in one of the time at the bottom of the hill. You know, so, I mean, so I did talk to him about it and.
Good.
Something to think about.
Excellent, thank you.
Right.
All right, where are we? We're in town administration. All right, thank you, Jackie.
Thank you, have a good night.
You too. So budgets, as you know, I sent the Q1 budgets, including the revenue and my summary notes along. If you have any questions here, I'm happy to try to answer them. There are no questions. I'll go on to 2019. I did finish the, SIP is ready, Denise.
Okay.
But I don't think Caroline was here to print them out, so.
Okay, I could get a copy from her, or you can send it to me?
Yes, but what I was really thinking is, and we talked about this, is administratively meeting, so I could talk to you about what's there. So.
Yeah.
And I would love to do that.
Okay, yeah.
And we can either do it, or we can talk about when that.
Sure, yeah, okay.
And also just the regular budget timeline, I know that, Jonathan is trying to work things out with SB2.
Yeah.
So I would like to have one of us, and if there's time, I could do it, sort of draft a letter to, you know, the trustees, anybody who does a budget. Say, we would really like to have it by, I don't know, what, September 15?
We have to be earlier, sure.
So we'll try, so we'll do September 15th and see if they, you know, throw rotten apples at us. But I think that would be a good thing to do. Manager of the transfer station, that just requires reviewing the budget. I have not had time to look at it, so we'll just kind of table that. Management response, this is the auditor, I'm working on this and I will send you a link so that if you have thoughts or comments to make as I'm writing it, you can just add them, so I'll send the link to you. Some of them are weird and I don't know how we're going to respond. Fortunately, none of these are material findings. We have had no material findings. These are all, you know, here are some deficiencies I've noticed, but they're not material findings.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah. I think the only material finding we've had, maybe there were two, but one was the recognition, when the money was here, there and everywhere. So that is no longer the case. And I think also the first time he looked at the transfer station, we had no controls over receipts and money.
Right.
So that was a material finding, so we addressed both of those. So this is more in the line of, you know, here's some things you could be thinking about to make things better. Michael, anything you wanted to say about the transfer station?
Yeah, I started reviewing the ordinance to make suggested edits specifically around what's listed here in practice versus what the ordinance says about transferring stickers and the resident versus owner issue that we've run into.
Yes.
Before I make any suggested changes to the board, I want to talk to Kate and Andrea and hear about any other issues they may deal with around stickers.
Yep, okay.
You know, I think we'll do it.
Yeah, if we're gonna do it, I'd still try to make it as comprehensive as possible.
If we need to do anything else, I don't want to.
Excuse me.
Or suggest something and they come to me and say, well, why didn't you talk to us about it, something else, something. We could table it for next week.
Sure, sure. Dumpsters, this is related, dumpsters are building of four or more units. So, shall we ask, I know somebody's compiling a list or somebody knows a list or whatever, but should we ask Tom to draft a letter?
Sure. That'd be great, but Andrea and Kate are compiling the list for.
Chad also has.
Chad.
Has information on that as well. Now, none of, you know, none of these may be exhaustive, but at least it's a start, right?
Right.
Okay.
The Chad was a good place to start, I'm sorry.
Denise, what?
Where do I ask a question about the email that we received from Kate on the permit? For the transfer station? Did you read that email?
Maybe not.
Someone who has a building permit on Roberts Road and wanted a transfer station certificate, and but his vehicle is registered in Maine, but he's building in Rollinsford, and he wanted to have access to the transfer station.
He's not a resident.
So he's a property owner. I mean.
Yeah, this is where I get so confused. I mean.
Me too, because that's, and their fear is he'll dispose of stuff from Maine that, in New Hampshire and whatever, but, I mean, we're being a little hard on certain issues.
If he wants, he's clearing, or she, I don't know who it is, but they're clearing.
They're clearing land, yeah.
So they're gonna have brush maybe to bring to the transfer station, you know, right?
Possibly, yeah. Or even just a bag of, and stuff, like cans and stuff that they're working there, you know, I mean, can we give them something with a.
We can give a temporary one.
A temporary one at least, and say that, I mean, no furniture, no this, no that, you know, or something, so if you're fearing that they're bringing something from Maine into New Hampshire, but I think we have to be a little flexible, they're building in our town. I don't know, maybe.
I would limit it to brush and construction related. And just leave it at that. I wouldn't, I think if you spell out, you know, so they have lunch, I don't think you wanna get that specific, but the waste has to be generated in our town, right? So.
That's the ordinance.
I would be very careful. That's all. I think sometimes they are a little cautious, I can't grant you that, overzealous sometimes too, but.
Are you saying something different from Denise though?
I'm saying not to let them have their bag of trash that they consumed or while they were having lunch there or something, you know, that's what you're saying.
Take it back to where they want it back to. I mean, because I share the concern that when they clean up their house in Maine to Rollinsford, all that comes with it, and it wasn't none of that was generated here, so I.
But.
I can be the odd man out, so you took an issue with a permit, that's fine.
I have in my house. I have in my house a lot of stuff that was not generated here at Rollinsford. I mean, it's furniture from my great aunts, my grandmother, my whatever. When I get rid of it, I'm gonna bring it to the Rollinsford whatever. Do you want to?
Yeah, but you didn't just move here yesterday. You've been here for a while, right?
Would he be able to have a dumpster?
Say it again.
Would he be able to have a dumpster?
Would he be able to have a dumpster?
Usually dumpsters are.
Yeah, he could have one.
He could put one there for if he had any, and it would be his responsibility to have it.
Honestly, if he's doing construction, he should have a rollaway there anyways, but really should have it, but.
Well, yeah, they're just at the clearing stage right now.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Which, that's why I think I'm also kind of concerned right now, just because they're only at the steering, clearing stage. What kind of garbage are they generating there that they need a dump for? That's the.
How about this? How about if we have Caroline just give them a call and say, what do you need?
What do you need?
What do you need?
Yeah.
We just need some clarification.
Okay.
How does that sound? Thank you. Is that on here?
I didn't see it. I just saw the email that we got.
Oh, email, okay, yeah.
I saw it coming, I didn't forget that.
It's on Roberts, yeah.
And it was 10-8.
So dumpsters, okay, we talked about deep, right?
Yes.
Yes, we're gonna talk draft about, okay. So Lambre truck sale, demo and hauling, I think that's just to get, make sure the whole board, and we may be all up to date, but we sold the truck?
Yeah, well, yeah, we're in the process of selling, yeah.
Yeah.
This is, I think, the placeholder for, we probably should actually move this up. E should be up under highway now.
So they need to find a new one, right?
Right, because that's why we kept it on the placeholder. George is working on.
And he is, I think he is working on.
So we should just leave it there.
All right, leave it there, thank you. There is, Caroline did write, did you see the draft she wrote for, to add to the newsletter?
Yeah, I did.
So I think she sent it just this afternoon, Mike, but it addresses, remember the letter we got from Shipyard that said, you know, we're gonna have to be careful about what's in that single stream recycling, you know, no like Hannaford bags or Duluth bags or, right? And no food debris. So there, the cleaner the recyclable stuff is, the better it is. So, and I have been reading about this in more general terms, and so I'm not surprised about hearing this. And so Caroline drafted something, which I thought was fine, I just changed the spelling of something. And it's going to be in the newsletter unless we object, so. And you saw it, so you're okay, I saw it and I'm fine, so Mike.
I'll take a look at it.
And the other thing she was suggesting is, Selma, do you remember what it was? She had two paragraphs, one was on the recyclables.
The other thing she's to write about is the, this grant money for.
Oh, yes, house improvements, a certain age and.
Yeah, she, I don't know if somebody walked through or she found out, but USDA provides grant money to folks over 61 if they fall within the certain income range, to help them, you know, if they have to put grab bars or roof or, so there's a paragraph, isn't that good?
Yeah.
So that's a great thing, we should also have it on our website, but going out on the newsletter is a good idea too. Okay, so, all right, upgrading Shady Lane to class 5.
Yeah. So we've been contacted by the owners of the LaVoy's on Shady Lane. We went through the planning board process to get approval to build a single family home on the now subdivided back lot.
So the subdivision has gone through.
Subdivision apparently was recorded at the registry in December last year, so,
excuse me.
Which they have the right to do. I talked to Tom Clark today about it. I guess that means now they start getting taxed on two buildable lots, but anyways, that was their decision. So they would like to meet with Tom and a representative from the board the planning stuff, I said I'd be happy to go. I figured as much, but to go over and look at the road, the current class 6 road, and go over with them. Tom has a list of state standards for class 5 roads to which they will have to go to. So, one of the conditions of planning board approval was Shady Lane to get a building to be buildable. Right? So the next step will be them coming to us asking for a building permit. So Denise hasn't sat through all this, so she doesn't know the backstory. So it says class 6 road, planning board doesn't, zoning ordinance does not allow building on class 6 roads unless there's a variance that's granted by the ZBA or the road is brought up to class 5 standards. It's still will be classified as a class 6 road. It still is a class 6 road, but to be able to build on it, we require them to, so a fire truck can get through.
We wrote policy guidelines, so they're not ordinances, they're just guidelines for boards, because we can't compel future boards to do anything.
Right.
And so the guidelines, you can read them, they're on the website. If I don't send you one, just ask me, I'll show you where it is. So they were guidelines. What, and I just wrote this in the agenda. So we are not upgrading Shady Lane to a class 5 road.
Right.
We are upgrading Shady Lane to class 5
standards. Correct.
It remains a class 6 road. We will not maintain it.
Correct.
Any deed that they record has to say, just like the deed that Sonny Vermette has, that they, whoever owns that home, is maintaining that road. The town does Zippo. And so if they want emergency services in the wintertime or any time of year, it is up to them to make sure that emergency vehicles can get to them. So I would just, I didn't like this in the agenda. So we're upgrading Shady Lane to class 5 standards or specs or something like that. where.
It's only a certain portion, so it's a minimum of 545 feet. That's 645. My glasses are so small. I think it was. Trying to do it closer, better read it. It's 645. I apologize. So. So we would go over that with them and show them what the specification would be. The understanding that would be, this is just a conversation. They still need to come to the select board and formally request that they're upgrading a town road. It's ours. We have to get permission to do this.
Yeah, we need to. Have you figured out what vehicle?
So there's a.
Buys that? I mean, I understand building permits. This right. is like you're so working on a road.
Part of our guidelines, which I don't have in front of me, I go get them. We require a memorandum of understanding or
okay.
agreement, same difference, as to what is expected of the landowner.
Okay.
Of maintaining the road, that we plow and all that stuff. Or if it's not, that the town is not liable, if a fire truck can't get up, it's not our problem. You know what I mean? If it's plowed, I mean, if it's a blizzard, I mean, obviously, it's not going to get there. Snow blowing, it's the road constantly, but, you know, within reason. So emergency services can get there. But the town doesn't plow. I mean, there'd be a whole list of provisions as to what the town will be responsible and not responsible for, and what the landowner is responsible for or not responsible for. And I don't have it in front of me, but it is part
of
the guidelines.
All right, so
then
we'll,
okay. So, oh, yeah, I mean, that's another step in the process.
So, I'm just curious, what is the vehicle that by which, because they can't just go out and take a bulldozer and start working
they,
on,
no, they cannot.
On our Class 6 road?
So, Tom and I proposed meeting, and I haven't heard that. Meeting with Little Boys on Monday, the 21st, that next Monday. I think it's next Monday.
Well, today's the 14th.
Yeah, today, of course. So we had 7 to 14, it's 21. Next Monday morning, they have responded to our budget account. To go over, these are what the state requires to be considered a Class 6 road. Now, I don't think anyone
plus
really
five.
Plus five, I guess.
That's
I never said that. Thanks. Anyone really wants to save more paved surfaces, we don't have to. I mean,
well, that's you know.
But it said that was the
requirement.
That's the problem. It has to be up to Class 5 specs.
Yeah,
so.
I mean that's. I mean, look what happened with Franklin. You know, the forest that they were.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You know,
yeah,
they're
yeah.
they're difficult.
Sure.
Decisions. You know, that this action helps one thing,
right.
but harms this.
Well, I mean, the law was very clear. If these folks were willing to go to these, I don't want to call them extremes, because they may not think it's extreme, but to go to meet these certain steps, they're allowed to build on that road, or to get a variance, of course, through the ZBA.
If we sign a building permit, we still need to sign.
We would still need to be able to sign a building permit, but yeah.
And it is slightly beyond the 600.
It's 45.
Yes.
And again,
I said slightly.
I mean, they're, like you said, they're guidelines.
They're guidelines.
Which I think, honestly.
My own personal opinion is I'm amenable to this. But
oh, yeah,
the
I'm
board,
just saying,
the
but,
board,
they're,
but
they're guidelines.
You have to be honest and say they're guidelines, and it has to be a board.
And I would also suggest that. As it's a new board that's been seated, sat.
Whatever.
After
yeah,
the
we are,
election,
yes.
We should probably be re-adopting the guidelines. I mean, I think that should be a practice. I guess you don't have to do
the
it.
The guidelines
but,
say.
I
think
that
the guidelines say it's up to the board that there's nothing in the guidelines.
To, you know, I mean,
yeah,
just,
I mean, I'm
I think it's a good practice. So, but we don't have to. We don't want to. But I think it's a good practice for boards to get that habit.
I think the caveat says, though, that no board is...
Has to follow it.
That's right.
Yeah. And you feel that's okay, then that's fine.
I read it again and make sure that that's there, but I felt there was enough in there that recognize the fact that, hey, look, this is just here to help boards try to reach a decision.
Right.
But no board is under any obligation to follow these, and every board can make its own decision.
Okay.
Because they're
like
just...
It just seemed to me that it would be... If there are guidelines that the select board may or may not follow, I mean, even if we adopt them, we don't have to follow them. It says we don't have to.
That's correct.
But I think it's a nice practice that it says that the select board has reviewed them again. I know it's just taking more time out of my meetings, but at least it looked at them again, and they're still pertinent, and they don't need to revise it yet. You know what I mean? Because another situation comes up we haven't thought about, and we need to change it again. I mean, not to suit a bigger situation, but so we can deal with it again in the future. I mean, it seems to me it's a good practice to review them every year, right? Because there may be sections that just don't pertain anymore, or sections we need to revise because we've learned that we have issues over the year. That's all. But I'm not losing sleep if we don't do it. But I just think that's a good idea.
It's not that I disagree with you, Michael, but
you know,
it's you know, the list is this long.
I get it.
Right. So.
I mean, and I guess in
trying to do the most important thing at any one particular.
And in truth, I mean, we've had.
We will be reading them. I'll be reading them when this building permit comes our way.
30-something years, 40 years. We've only had two of these in the last, well, not three, in the last 40 years. So. Going on the class 6 road like this, so. New construction.
Okay.
Plenty before us, but.
All right, are we good with
that? Yeah, that's just the update. So if you're okay
I'm
with
okay.
me meeting with Tom and the applicants,
yeah.
Start the process.
What's on 402 Stockdale Drive? Oh, is that the one where they're building a second one and it's...
They have. They've been utilizing it. Tom Clark was going to... I didn't see an email from Caroline today. Again, I wasn't on email for half the day, but what does it say?
I thought she said she was going to have Tom Clark.
So they can't do it,
or something. They're going over a sidewalk.
Yeah,
that's the problem. And it's not really a driveway, it's just something that they've used for years.
Yeah.
And it's just now been brought to the attention of people. But they're definitely going over a sidewalk, which they shouldn't be allowed to do.
Right. Okay, so we're having Tom draft a letter.
I think it said that that was including maintenance and stuff.
No,
I think it said that.
Penalty associated with it.
Yeah, it's $100
a day.
Right, so to have him. So
maybe the request was to have him draft a letter and show it to us, just because
you
of
know,
the,
just because of that finding,
of the finding.
Because there's a fine that goes with it, and it's a daily fine.
Yeah.
So I would say
yeah, that's
give her the go ahead to have him draft the letter,
yeah,
and then
we should see it. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. I mean,
okay.
They've claimed that they've been doing what did they say, 15 years.
Well, they've been parking there ever since they've lived there, but they're still going on their sidewalk.
Yeah, I don't think it makes any difference. Because the sort of 20-year squatter's rights or whatever,
yeah.
Because
right,
it doesn't
right, right.
pertain to municipal
right,
property.
Right, right.
Right.
So,
I just think
and it wasn't 20 years, it's only...
Yeah.
I don't believe it has been going on for 15 years.
So. Whatever. Okay, I'm running out of steam just a little bit, so I'm going to try to keep us focused. But I don't want to not have a good conversation if we need one. Is there anything else we need to say about Stockdale? All right, the newsletter notices, I think that's what the two paragraphs that Caroline had written. So, you know, if there's anything else you want to add, I would say I've looked at them. I'm really fine with them. I just added, I put a new paragraph. I didn't add the paragraph. I just started the paragraph. Yeah, it was just this afternoon, probably. And again, if one was on, it's the same, it's, I believe, I don't know if it's two. Anyway, it's two different sections.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see.
One is on recyclables and one is on the grant, which is a very good thing.
Oh, okay. Yeah, no, this is fine.
All right. What's to say about anything to say about the recreation committee? Who would you like to come up and talk to us soon? I have limited intellectual capacity at the moment, so I'm hoping that my colleagues here will. Keep us on the right track, Bill.
Okay. I
have gotten approval from the chairs of the committee for two grants. This is the first, I'll print out the first one to Eastern Bank, which I will need help from Caroline or someone else in the town if requests information about fiscal agent and who the fiscal agent of the town is and so forth. Then the other one that we have gotten information for that we feel comfortable going ahead with is Dick's Sporting Goods, and I don't see that I have a printout of that one, but I did send it by email this afternoon. And then this is what we are asking. I have three copies of this. This is what we are asking Dick's for. I took this paragraph Suzanne wrote and just changed one word because you had commission one spot and committee another spot. So I aligned
the two.
You're
a committee. Thank you.
I aligned the two words, and
thank you.
They are the, that is the first paragraph of our history as requested by Eastern Bank, and then it goes into demographics from last year as requested by the chair and stuff. For the Eastern Bank, we decided to request $2,000 because the average donation request is $2,500 for our category. That breaks down to, and it's specifically written in our request, $800 to bring in glass fusing through little mugs. Last year we spent $780 for that, so that increases it $20, allows us a little bit of leeway. $250 to go to the Wentworth House. Last year we worked with the Wentworth House. We were charged $100, but we were informed that did not cover their supplies, and we only took about 20 students over there. So hopefully the $250 will allow us to take over more students and allow us to sufficiently pay them for their supplies. Another $800 for bringing in pottery through Little Bugs so that the kids would do a glass project and a paint pottery project. And then the last $150 would go towards the teen camp to cover rainy day activities when they cannot go out to hike and go to these other things. It would include a trip to the movies or Blitz Air Park, one of the other activities that we are already.
What?
Blitz Air Park.
Blitz Air Park.
It's in Portsmouth. It would provide the fees to cover the campers for that camp.
What is that?
Blitz Air Park? Mm-hmm. It's a big trampoline place. It's full of trampolines. So that is what you're requesting from. And if we need to cut it down, I've requested half the amount down to $1,050, which would bring in Doodle Bugs once for glass fusing and the Wentworth House. So
the teams go on, I'm sorry, three field trips in the what is it, grades 1 through 8 go on one, like Friday.
So the teen camp is gone every day, and they're there 3 days a week, so every day they're somewhere. The campers at Camp Raleigh, grades 1 through 8, go two field trips a week. One looks like it's going to be Thursdays to state parks and Fridays to the Jenny Thompson Pool in Dover. This would bring people in to the camp, and these are things that the director has already asked to have returned from last year.
Now, you have no problems, if you run this by Kate, just make sure that these, they can be inside the building. Are you talking about inside the building?
For
these demonstrations, since I know there's going to be some construction projects happening. So I just want to make sure that you've cleared it with Kate that there is going to be availability for these in-house projects and when.
I have not let talk to her. Right now, the director's in charge of that. I can
direct the director to do it.
I can do that
just to make sure that they're.
Last year when Jeff.
Well, sometimes we just like assume.
Right.
But
it's the annex, and that's the area in which you're going to be at. They're going to get a new roof, so you want to make sure that you have the availability.
Just one other simple thing.
in this first sentence, I think you want to say surrounding.
Yes. I have not talked to Keith, but what Doodlebugs has gone into several different community schools outside of this. They've worked with the schools in Madbury, Dover, and South Florida.
When
so,
is the date?
July 30th.
So it's really not her, but I mean, you have to
something.
Run
start
it somewhere.
There.
You have to
no,
get
no,
some
I know. Start
permission
there.
Somewhere. I'm not saying she's not going to let it come to the school, but I'm just saying, is it available to come into the school with the projects that are going to happen? That's my question.
Last time I knew, the director did inform us that we would be having one classroom and partial use of the gym. So, and that's where they set up last year, was in the gym.
You're going to have painting going on in the gym?
Mm-hmm. They set up tables, and each child gets a small, there are usually 4 or 6 cups on a tray. It's like a muffin tin, mm-hmm. but it's plastic. And they are given each like a quarter cup of every color. And Doodlebugs brings in placemats and does all the cleanup and stuff. But I will check with Kate.
We'll just run it.
Yeah. And I did get a copy of the budget I'm going to be looking at to make sure that this is all covered. The chair and I were talking outside earlier today, the one thought that she had is like you to confirm that the money is, there is enough money in the budget to accept all the grants coming in. The line items, because I believe she put in $2,500, but then contingency money was putting in too.
So let me make sure I understand. Yes, the money, and we, the board, didn't keep the detail analysis, the D and together. So we just have that one bottom line. So yes, you do need to make sure that the expenditures, whether they're covered by grants or not, if the expenditures that are in those two lines don't exceed. They don't, you know, it can't, the teen camp can exceed by 500 if the other one is 500 or less. That, it's the total, bottom line total.
And
just,
so, if those are okay with you, I can talk to Caroline and make sure that she can help me on the Eastern Bank financial.
So you don't need our signatures just yet?
I don't think she needs our signatures, just need our blessing, right?
Is that true?
I need your blessing to send it in to, these are automatic online submissions.
So will there be, will there be anything to sign that says we accept this award? Sorry for using the articulation that I'm used to in other.
Well, this is the one that you told me that the only one that can have a signature is you. Is this the one?
I'm the Eastern Bank one. The only you, the select board gets an email to notify
that you've done it.
That we've done it, and
the only signature is yours.
It's not necessarily a signature. The only my login for the computer is the only one that can change it. And if you were to create a login, you would create a separate account with a separate application. I do not believe there's anything to sign, but I can check.
I don't know really who the fiscal agent is. I mean, are they talking about the treasurer, or are they talking about the people who are actually responsible for spending the money, which would be us? I'm not sure I understand. I don't know the answer to that question. So
the fiscal agent is usually the person who does the approval, isn't it?
That would be us.
That would be us.
Yes.
I believe that, I mean, that would be my interpretation.
Okay. I mean, I don't know why the treasurer would have to
it.
Right. So we're the ones who just say yes.
Yeah.
Yes or no.
That's Eastern.
Eastern. And you're asking Eastern for how much?
$2,000.
And if we get all $2,000 that we're going to spend, that 2,000 is in your, part of your budget request in there.
And it's for the painting and the fusing, it's out of the $2,000. And then the other one, Dix, is for product, it's for equipment, whatever.
Yeah, okay, so and is Eastern, no, it's Optimum Bank, remember the one?
And I have a call into that.
Isn't that interesting that they would do workshops, that is,
The person at Optimum Bank, the person that runs their grant program, is out of town until May 22nd, so I have a call into them to get back to me.
I was intrigued by that.
But Eastern Bank, I've talked to her a couple of times, they have one person in their office, so I think
that's the perfect thing to do. Talk to the grant officer, whatever coordinator, whatever the person's name is.
Foundation coordinator.
What is it that you'd like to fund, what's your average, so that you're not writing an application that's completely something that's foreign to them. So it's a great thing to do, it gets a relationship going, you know, your interest shows your interest. Perfect thing to do.
And if you miss it this time, it's better off than getting there for the next time.
And this one is a rolling deadline, and so is Dix. The Optimum Bank is a dead May 31st for June 15th notification.
Mm-hmm. So you may not be able to do that, but still meet with them and still find out.
And
next
so
year to be more prepared.
The rec committee is meeting this Sunday, and we'll be talking about the Optimum Bank one, and we just got something from the Strawberry Festival in South Berwick. I signed up for that. However, I might have to send it to you, Denise. I don't think the rec committee will qualify, because it says you can not be eligible for town funds. And so that may disqualify the rec committee.
What is the Strawberry Festival?
Well, they give away
grants.
Is it a grant? Yeah, they give grants to nonprofits, and
they do.
That's what they do with their money.
Really?
And
they make it.
I think they give actually, scholarships as well to students.
And they don't keep it in South Berwick necessarily?
South Berwick, volunteer
in Elliott.
And I was reading through the information today, $100 to $1,000, and if you are doing a match, you have to prove you already have the funds.
Yeah, so these are the parts of the grants that get me worried, because sometimes there are these obligations associated with them, and that's why the board needs to review these.
So for the Strawberry Fest, you have to have volunteers sign up to run, either serving strawberries, shortcake, or doing kids games, which would have been
is
ideal.
Eating strawberry shortcake considered a volunteer activity?
We'll talk about this on Sunday night more in depth. But in your folder, there is a PO for the rec committee. You should have already gotten a email from me saying we got the grant, or we got sponsorship of the shirts from
C&J. That was wonderful from C&J, so that's excellent.
Very nice.
So again, however, the cost of the shirts are in the budget. This is just the rep. We now have secured the revenue, but the cost was also in the budget. Expense budget. Okay.
Right. Is that a yes or no?
That is a yes.
Okay.
So
thank you, C&J.
My question to you is, does that count as a grant, or does that count as t-shirts in our budget? As income for t-shirts, because
that would be t-shirts.
Well, the spending is the spending. All right, so spending is on whatever supplies or whatever your line is in D's, or I just say it's D, but she's here.
She did.
Yeah.
Did I stop putting it together?
So if you're going to account at that level of detail, and at some point, the board is going to be accounting at a better level of detail. Because it just,
yeah,
it's better for us.
Yeah, but wouldn't it be just a donation, and then it's not a grant.
Okay.
It's a donation.
Right, so, but on the expense side, it's supplies.
Yeah.
All right. On the income side,
donation.
It's a donation,
yeah. It's not a grant.
It's not really a grant.
I mean,
he's just giving us the money.
He requested money for this purpose.
It's a gift.
It's a gift.
It's a gift.
A gift or grant. I mean, gift or a donation.
Yeah. And we are allowed to accept them because of the you know, what the town meeting says. So you know, Caroline will have an accounting nightmare, but
you know, she seems to be good at managing those.
Yeah, well, the same thing happened last year, right? You paid for the.
Yeah, this is a this year is a $250 increase because we found out.
You had to buy more.
We found out we did not cover, we were about, last year it came in around 1510, so we were a little shy in our budgeting. And we are buying more for the teen camp and the teen camp counselors.
And I would say anywhere the rec committee is, just bring that poster that says your spot, you know.
It's gonna be on the back, right?
On your sponsors.
It's gonna be on the back of all.
Yeah, for the t-shirts, but I mean, yeah, you know.
Yeah.
Just anywhere and everywhere you are, just bring your list of sponsors and say, yay, thank you guys.
Yeah, so that's on our agenda for talking about on Sunday, how to thank the sponsors and get them exposure.
Okay, Seco's printing, that's on.
That's us.
Seco's printing is their t-shirts.
Oh, like the t-shirts.
Yeah.
That order's gonna go in by the end of the week. That's okay.
So, you'll just come back and talk to Caroline about that.
We're gonna come and see her anyways. We'll do it tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right.
It probably won't be me, it'll probably be the director.
Brittany, powers.
Yes.
Powers.
Powers.
Not spears.
No.
Powers.
Right.
Got it.
Spears.
No. All right. We've talked about visioning. We've got things to read and we'll keep it on the list. SRPC appointment, Judith Nelson is gonna be resigning from as an SRPC commissioner as of June 1st. I had mentioned to the board, you may have forgotten a while back, something like this was going to happen soon. And I suggested that the board consider our appointing Caroline to as an SRPC commissioner, but as our staff person. So in other words, we'd hire for hours and she would report to us about whatever, things like that. Is the board agreeable with that?
Yeah, half hours. How many hours is it? Once a month, right?
It is once a month. There is a 1 to 1.5, sometimes 2 hour meeting on Friday mornings. And then four times a year, four quarters, there's a meeting at 4 o'clock that lasts an hour and a half or so.
So there's a half hour up to Rochester, right? And a half hour back. If you're sending a staff member, sending the right citizen, the travel time, the time of the meeting, about 4 hours, once a month,
once a month.
Okay. Do you think she has enough time for it? I mean, I understand, I mean, I go to the TAC meeting tonight, I completely agree that the vast majority of communities send staff, I mean, they don't there's us in Farmington and maybe one other town that sent a staff, that sent a selectman, just like there was a member on the rest of the staff, so, but they also probably have full-time staff to do that, so, if you think that she has enough time,
I know she has the interest. I would challenge the board then, say, how do we find someone who will go, understand the needs of the town and report back things that might be of interest.
I think she's a good candidate to do it, to be honest, but my concern is, does she have the time during the month to go, that's all. We ask a lot of her. I understand she may have interest, but I have interest in other things too, but I just want to have the time to do them, you know what I mean, so.
Sure, sure. So how would you like to proceed? Would you want to invite her in to talk to us about this? Would that be helpful?
I'm okay with her doing it, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I'm okay.
I mean, I think that if she has the interest and stuff, I mean, this is stuff that's during the day and limits us that can go.
Yeah.
So try it and see what happens. And if it interferes with her day too much or her week too much, she will let us know.
Yeah.
Right?
Having been a commissioner, and I still am, although I'm probably not going to stay much longer myself, those meetings are like a fire hose coming right at you, because, you know, it'll be on public health one time, and they have all these people, all these great ideas, all these programs, and the state left this, that, and the other thing, you go, well, that's awfully nice, you know, what the hell, you know, what do we do?
Right.
We had no personnel. But I was at a meeting when the DES sent Liz Strahan to this meeting, who said, you know, we have this DARE grant program, you know, for fire, you know, for if you have a decent, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
So that one meeting gave us $110,000 toward our fire engine. And it, you know, somebody needed to bid him that meeting who sort of understood the ramifications of that, realized that it could benefit the town, and come back and tell the town. So that's the kind of person that I think the board needs. And so that's why I know there's a lot on Caroline's plate. We're shallow benched. I don't have a solution. Let's continue to think about it, Mike, so that you feel better about it. Or
if you're ready to act tonight, you can. That's okay. I just thought of something we should think about. That's all.
Yeah. So we can take another week to think about it.
Totally.
All right.
Sure.
But do you want to think about it with Caroline?
Yeah, she should probably come in.
All right. So we'll do that.
You're planning on stepping down in the near future as well?
Yeah, I actually missed so many meetings because in the fall I had this thing. I mean, it's a little bit worse now, so I missed, or we've traveled, or it's on Fridays, and we go to the Boston Symphony a lot on Fridays. It just hasn't worked out. So, I mean, Judy's been a lot more valuable to SRPC than I've been because she's on the executive committee and she's been doing a lot of stuff for them, including the hiring of the replacement. But let's she really needs to resign, so she's going to resign, and we'll ask Caroline to check. All right. Landfill post closure. Mike, were you going to talk to George about this?
I have it right here.
I
good, okay. Because we're going to keep saying that. MS4 permitting. So,
can we move that under highway?
Yes, so, of course.
I think 4 cents when he's here.
Yes.
Okay.
MS4 permitting. So, Lord, I'm terribly remiss. Many apologies to the board, the town, to anybody and everybody. So we have to do our annual report, which is probably going to be a little bit late. And that one doesn't concern me too much. I can take care of that. I'm trying to get a meeting of the Stormwater Committee together because a new permit is coming up in July, and we need to file the notice of intent by sometime in October. So we need to get cracking on this thing. So I'm just letting us know that this is a serious obligation on the town.
I'm surprised to see that EPA finally came out with the application for the permit.
It's been out for a while.
Well, but the final rules were...
There was something recently.
Recently, right.
But it was, I think, only on one car. I mean, the permit is effective, I believe, July 1. The notice of intent is due sometime in October. So hopefully, you know, we'll be able to have the resources to get this all in place. I do have something to say about the conversation about meeting twice monthly. So one of the issues that we have with building permits is that the zoning thing says select board, select board, select board. I would like to write to the Municipal Association and ask them, does that imply or designee? Because maybe it does. So I'm going to ask them. And that may help us say it's okay to have Tom sign it. Let's find out. Oak Street boundary. Still too wet to do perambulation?
Well, it rained on Saturday, okay. And Sunday was Mother's Day, so...
That's all right.
I decided that...
No worries, Mike. You don't notice
the harmony of my house was that I might not go up for a walk on that day.
Exactly. So, town administration, board member activities. There is a budget committee with the first quarter review for the town on Wednesday. And this week I'm working on the management response, and I've got you guys links. And hopefully meet with Denise about the SIP. And there was one other thing I really wanted to do, but I have to start on the in organizing the stormwater.
Are you going to be up to doing Wednesday's meeting?
If something happens that I'm not, can you be?
One of my show, and if you, oh, yes, I can.
Okay.
I can. So either way,
all right.
I can be here, or I can come, and if you're not, I can take over.
All right.
And not feel one.
I'll see what all of this does to me tomorrow.
Okay, yeah.
This will be
I'll plan to be
test.
Coming and see what happens.
Super, thank
okay?
you.
No problem.
All right. Anything else going on with us this week that we know about?
I'm going to be at the CBA tomorrow night to just open up the meeting.
Excellent.
At the chair, yeah. And then I will leave.
Excellent.
Wednesday,
the budget.
I will
thank
come. And I'm going to organize a CIP meeting very soon.
Okay, good. So we'll try
so
to figure out a time.
Just kind of get it up and going. People thinking about what's going. I'm also going to set up a meeting for the police station as
yeah.
well, getting that going. Did you say that you had the CIP, so that figure that Bob was looking for is on there? You're going to send that to me?
It is right in there.
It's in where?
It's in the CIP.
Yep. Did you, is it in the budget?
Did I highlight it? I don't remember it.
I was looking for the sheet that said that these are the things that we have, this is how much money is spent in it so far, and the total going into the police station is this.
It's part of the spreadsheet.
That's part of the spreadsheet.
And that's in that in the budget packet?
Not the budget packet that I just handed. Not
no.
the quarter one review.
Okay.
In the CIP.
On Google Drive.
It's not on the drive, but it's what I asked Caroline to print out for you and what I will
Oh, that's
give you.
The one. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, so she's going to, okay.
Yes, but
okay.
I'm going to go through it with you.
Very good. Okay.
So
yeah.
that you can see how these things,
yeah.
you know, I've built it over the years so that there's better tie-in with what the trustees think is in the, you know, so that we can reconcile and know what we've done from
yeah.
year to year.
Okay.
So that's what I kind of would
and
like to
that's what we're going to do when we meet to do our
yes.
administrative.
Yes.
Okay, gotcha.
So I can
very good.
Tell you
all right,
here.
Thank you. That's all I have.
I have a new board met last week. Miles Benson was elected chair
Excellent.
Again, and John Henderson, the vice chair.
Very good. Okay, so I'll change it on the website to Miles. Chair. Sorry. Oh, John. J-O-H-N. I was. I had to apologize to him because I was doing J-O-N. Vice chair. Okay, very good.
I do have some POs. I don't know when I'm going to fall into the process. Right
well,
now,
let's do. I don't know. We usually do Michael.
Okay.
Oopsie. Okay, so we have a lot of building
oh,
permits.
I'm sorry, Mike. So this came from Celia.
That is the board copy.
That's the board copy.
And then there's a digital copy in your emails too.
Oh, but oh, even
so maybe
better.
We should have Caroline set up a file for grants,
yeah.
for recommending
oh, yes.
grants.
Then one other thing that says that you have to go over with Caroline. And
fiscal
that.
Agent, but we just decided we are the fiscal agent.
Okay, so that's good to go then, as soon as I get plugged in.
So
this will be our copy.
And I will confirm with the grant coordinator.
First one is 2018-027. Does not appear to have a number associated with it yet. It's on Silver Street, probably a tax map. It's tax map 19, lot 12-1. It's new construction. Mr. Clark has reviewed and updated the estimate of construction, so the fee will be $2,005.
Can I ask a question on the building permits? I've noticed that we've gotten a couple of letters from New Hampshire DOT about driveway permits or retard?
Yep.
Is that on any state road?
Yeah.
So when I get my driveway repaved, I have to get approved by the state?
By the state, yeah.
How long does that take?
I have no idea.
Just to repave?
Just to repave, it's already there.
We were talking last week at planning, which was last week, with, an applicant, and our consultant was saying that it's within a couple of weeks, there's a turnaround now for applications for driveway permits, it's pretty quick, so.
So is it something I get here, or is it something?
No, it's through the state DOT to contact someone that.
Well, I can look up just things that we got approved on. Okay, so I do have to get a building permit as well as filing it with the state, because I live on a state road.
Correct.
Okay.
Do you have to pay the state, or is it?
I don't know.
I don't know, I didn't see that.
Things to be odd.
Well, because there's a tie-in with the.
Well, because I'm gonna apply to the road.
Yeah, ties to the state road as well.
Maybe they just wanna make sure that the law, they're not, you're not changing the.
Of course, when they come in and do the tie-in for you, they don't do that.
They don't give a, yeah, you know.
I can't solve that, I'm sorry, but there's that, it's not.
All right.
Next one is 2018-035, 73 Rollins Road. Alterations and some demolition without utilities. They're demolishing, demo attached storage shed, building a new deck, remove double window and install a new patio door. Mr. Clark has reviewed, it is $175. Next is 2018-036, 2 Doherty Lane. Alterations also. Screen porch, okay. Mr. Clark has reviewed, it's $165 fee. If you want to look up the schematic, they're all attached. Next is 2018-038. 459 Stockdale Circle, electrical. Mr. Clark has reviewed, a $90 fee. Is 2018-039, 121 General John Sullivan Way. Also electrical. $90 fee. Next is 2018-042, 668 Silver Street. Also electrical. That's a $90 fee. Next is 2018-043. 151 Robert Road. Also electrical. Says the season to electrical work. Also been reviewed by Mr. Clark, the $90 fee.
Is that a standard fee for electrical?
Yes, that's a basic, the minimum.
Yeah, look at the back of the building permit.
says that somewhere.
It's $90, which includes the administrative fee or project valuation, whichever is larger, so. Typically, they don't have to go over 90, but sometimes they do. 2018-044, 14 Wentworth Street. It's HVAC, actually, this time, so. It is a $245 fee. That one. So, and we have 2018-046. That's not right. So the next one's the same number. All right, well.
There was an issue with numbering there, according to Caroline.
It's, Lot 1 Spruce Street. Oh, those new, okay. Doesn't have a number yet. It's map 9, lot 9-22, lot 1. It's a subdivided property from a few months back, last year, I think, late last year. So it's lot 1, Spruce Street. New construction, wow. Mr. Clark has reviewed, it's a $2,205 fee. So this one also was 2018-046. I mean, I'll just make a note that it's a duplicate.
Yeah, it will have to be reconciled.
Yeah.
One will have to be A. Why don't you put an A on it?
Yeah, yeah. Good idea.
A, how about that? It is 412 Railroad Avenue.
Is that that little road?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's possible this store.
Yeah.
They are doing a partial roof repair. Mr. Clark has reviewed, it's a $55 fee.
Let me see.
There you go. Moving right along. Next one, sorry, I went to your Arizona.
No, it's, I just didn't get that number. Okay.
All right, we have permit 2018-048, 69 Rollins Road, redoing their driveway. Mr. Clark has reviewed, it's a $75 fee.
So does that require state?
Mm-hmm. Does indeed. But, as I have been reminded in the past, the state to worry about. Rollins was getting it. The state can fine them if they want to.
Oh, yeah.
We're not in charge of the estates. I mean, you know, so.
We're not the enforcers.
We're not, but
we're not the king of me.
No, they're the king of us. next is 2018-051. One Front Street, number 201. It's in the mill. It's an electrical upgrade for the hair salon that's going in there. Permit. It's been approved by reviewed by Mr. Clark, it's $90.
You mean the cover, one of the cover bills?
It went through planning board. Minor, so it's an approved use of the mill, so in the mill district. So they have just a few upgrades, I guess. Alright, we'll put that here. 650 151 Roberts Road. Electrical also.
How do you get
that? It's appears to be a generator. So Jeff Clark had reviewed it. Can't really see the it's a photocopy of it, but it's $155 fee. So granted, expires on. Sign down here because can't see us. Ah, and we've come to the end of the line for building permits, but wait, there's always more. We need to sign the state MS-1234, which is a report of town city village officials. That's compiled by our town.
Her signature is not sufficient.
Apparently not. We signed off by the select board, I guess. I don't know. I can see my address. It looks it's correct. And I don't know anybody else's address, so I don't know how we sign off on it, but it's all of us who signed it apparently, so we just start from there.
Well, she got these from the website, and they're correct. It looks like she did. Not really, the report doesn't really differentiate between a full member and an alternate. Office owner, or you can say management director.
Yes.
Do we have a town constable? Should we have a town constable?
No. No, she's a policeman. Do you want to go back to the days where we elected?
Was the town constable elected? Did
yes.
Do you remember a time when there was one?
Uh-huh. Robert England. Robert England was Miles was the
father.
Wasn't
he? He was called constable. so they don't care about the alternates on the budget committee. Did I say alternates?
Yeah.
Is she on?
Yeah, we don't have alternates.
All right, I've looked at it and it looks okay to me, so I'm willing to sign it. They're just a lot more lines in case they only had 12 members on the board or more.
Hey, okay, so the last thing we have in my folder anyway is a form of a land use change tax form for the fifth property. It's already been, it needs to be filed.
Is that FYI?
It needs to be filed with the registry.
So we have to sign anything?
Yeah.
I think we've already received the money, actually.
We have, yeah. It's in, that's indicated on.
Oh, okay. I think we've received it quarter one, I think, because it's on the, our revenue report.
We received it on 3/19/18.
Yeah.
So.
My address is wrong. Should I cross it off?
Yes,
your
correct.
Your address is wrong? Yeah.
Was this it that was signing on?
This is land use change tax form for.
If you recall, we've had conversations about Mr. Phipps's property on Turgeon Lane, and they filed a petition. They wanted to make sure that in fact he wanted to keep it in current use, and he thought he was following applicable laws. And you know, we brought it to Steve Roberts, and Steve talked to Paul Connolly and them, and as it turns out, it's not because of the way he
piece of it.
Yeah, but he didn't have enough contiguous pieces, so. We are signing, what are we signing here? And we're signing that. Can you see? Yep.
And that
we
was
did.
Taken out of current use notes.
And it's going to the. So there's the special revenue fund. We have two special revenue funds. This is if you remember at the training. So the land use change tax fund is a special revenue fund.
The use of the. He was doing it for using. Part of the land for compost. Compost isn't acceptable use for farming under the current use law. I mean,
they were referring to agricultural statutes, but when you're looking at this land use statutes, there are certain things that work and certain things that don't work. It was unfortunate, but that's the way it goes. So, yes, you want this package. So, James.
Yes, ma'am.
The two special revenue funds that we have, the land use change tax fund and hydro fund, probably have $65,000 in them. And so that's just something to keep in mind with regard to the police station. That could be another source of some revenue. I mean, the town would have to say. Yeah, you know, we authorize money to come from here. But that's
I'm done.
All right, I have.
Can I, before you do your folder, I'm so sorry to interrupt, I should have said this before. I'm gonna be unavailable for 3 Mondays in June. So the two of you are going to carry on. You are a fully authorized board. Please don't feel you need to table things. Just keep calm and carry on. And that the dates are the 3 Mondays after June 8th.
After June 8th?
Three Mondays after June 8th.
Out of town, 4/5 and 6th of June 4th. It's a very beautiful Baltimore.
It's a nice port.
Lovely in the area of summer. Yeah, you're suggesting we're gonna go to water. I'm thinking more like BWI filter or something.
I have a question. Did you read your email? Did you read your email response back from Vern about the conservation? And what's the big issue? Because I mean, there's a big issue there. Because what he showed us is what his treasury report said. However, our understanding was it's so much more, according to what's in the drawer.
Well, that was my understanding.
Well, isn't it in?
I was shocked. That's why I said, what is, all of a sudden, we've got this conservation account that has never shown up on treasurer's reports.
Yeah.
Beverly never showed them. And it had $800. And so I asked to put it on the thing, I guess, Carolyn.
About the checking account was done?
I don't know. I thought after the clearing that happened, the harvest, I thought we had tens of thousands of dollars in that account. Now, I could be completely wrong. Are you shaking your head thinking?
I was told that there's over 35.
That's so.
He's saying it's 800.
So I am really confused.
So I guess maybe we need to have direct them to pull out the checking book here that's been in the safe and make sure it's not at a different bank or something that he's not aware of.
Yeah, let's do the town clerk and Caroline and Vern and us.
Yeah, so that, make sure we understand.
Yes.
That's a huge difference.
When is the conservation commission meeting? Are they already there?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow.
And I told them that I thought they had like $40,000, but we were still in the process of trying to find the checkbook and.
Whoever gets elected as their chair tomorrow night, that should be included too.
They've already have, they do have a chair, it's Paul Cass.
Okay, so Paul Cass should be.
Yeah.
So they already met and organized us. That was my question.
Yes.
That was
yeah.
Last month.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think we should definitely get that resolved.
Town clerk, Caroline, us, and Vern.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Because
look at what's in.
I didn't know whether this was. Remember, there was a rec committee account that showed up the last time.
Oh, I know. That's
and
what I'm saying.
Now,
possibly,
like, what?
Maybe there's another bank account.
And he's also. There's probably paperwork in there about PDIP. PDIP
yeah.
is the where we've got some interest. PDIP's where we put our all of our, that looks like it. That's what it is. PDIP is where we put all of our proceeds from our loans.
Oh. Okay.
And then we transfer them to the general fund, but only the amounts that we needed that covered the authorization from the warrants. So what remains is the interest. And so I am authorized according to PDIP to move it,
mm-hmm.
but I asked Caroline to check with Vern because he may feel as treasurer that he really should be the one to move it, but he's gonna need to get the authorization. So he decided he wanted to move it, so we're gonna authorize him.
But you're gonna retain on it, they're removing Beverly.
Yes.
And they're?
We're closing. This is going to, this is the final act. We're going to close them. He's going to close them and move the interest to our citizens' bank.
Okay. All right, I'm going to do the 3 POs that I have.
Mm-hmm.
The first one is Seacoast Printing, T-shirts for campers and staff, $1,700, purchase order 1429.
Second.
I got it. Okay.
I think we had some discussion on it earlier. Any other further questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
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 Mm. The next one is purchase order 1288, Green Shadow Property Maintenance with the Cemetery Department. One for the New Town and Old Town Cemetery Mowing and Trimming, First Mowing. This is where I'm a little confused. It said First Mowing, $1,345. Is that really true? Okay, then.
Four times a year.
Yeah, most of the $18,000 goes to the mower.
Okay.
Well, they, you know, they've got all, they've got to go around.
They, yeah, that's really tricky.
And you have a hard time finding people to do it.
Okay, so.
Yeah.
All right, so.
I'm in.
Second.
Other comments or questions? All those in favor say aye.
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 Okay. And the next one is purchase order 1289, Green Shadow Property Maintenance for the cemetery. One for New Town and Old Town Cemetery Spring Cleanup for a total of $900.
Second.
Any comments or questions? All those in favor say aye.
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 My next one is this is a lawyer's bill for a boundary line dispute with the city of Dover for Roberts, formerly Phoenix, and how do you say the first name?
Hopeful.
Hopeful. For $35 now due.
I usually see those first, but I didn't see this one. Interesting. Oh, okay, so this is related to the perambulation, and it's not really, it's no longer a dispute.
Oh, okay. Oh, this is,
this,
okay.
So what, we could have just two copies.
No, this is something.
Oh, this is Comcast. This
okay,
is this
is a different one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So this, so when I spoke to John Storr, I believe you were already
mm-hmm.
on the board, and about Oak Street, and he said he would get his attorney, because he has one, the town has, the city has one, to start the MOA, saving us money. And so we haven't heard anything. So I asked Caroline to ask, you know, Kevin Baum to push that. Anytime you ask, it's $35. So there you go.
There you go. All right. I have another bill from the same law firm, and this is for Comcast for a total of $97.24.
So Comcast, this is. So they're looking at the, so they're trying to renegotiate our contract
mm-hmm.
with Comcast. When I was first on the board and we got the first renewal from Comcast, we got like an extension. So I said, well, a 2-year extension or whatever to the basic contract. So I said, well, innocently, where's the basic contract? No, What? Well, I said, well, how can we extend something? We don't know what the basic things are. So as it turned out, it was the original Continental Cablevision. It was in the, don't do that. It was in the vault,
mm-hmm.
1970, whatever it was.
Mm-hmm.
It was for 15 years with an automatic, unless somebody did something, 15-year renewal, which brought it to 2003 or 2. And from that point on, the board just kept signing extensions.
Mm-hmm.
And when we formed the, it's now disbanded, you know, the sort of accessible government committee early on, this, which got us to Google, which was just the best thing ever. We were talking about the Comcast, and Mike Gillis was on that committee, and he does the work for Dover, you know, all of the media work. And so, at this point, we can't just keep signing extensions, so we need a renewal. So last year, the board asked Steve to manage the renewal process and talk to Mike Gillis and see if they could do anything on our behalf. Now, one thing the board can consider is the franchise fee. So, I mean, Steve has not asked us this. This is just something I know and something we should at least be thinking about. So, the franchise fee is currently 3% for the city of Rawlins, the town of Rawlins. So, any of us who subscribe to Cablevision are paying a 3% franchise fee. Comes to the town, it's in the revenue line, Comcast. We could charge up to a franchise fee of up to 5%. I'm not suggesting we do, just saying we could. So if we wanted to consider like an increase of 0.25%, 0.5% to increase revenue, it's something we can think about. I'm neutral, just bringing that up as a possibility. Because that's entirely up to us and it would be part of the franchise renewal. Otherwise, I'm just going to say okay to this because this is what they're doing in our. The other thing that we asked them to do, Denise, a year ago, and we've never mentioned it again, so I feel quite sure they're not working on it. And we would want to meet to make sure that we still felt that way, but every once in a while we get. Let me sign this up. We get comments from people who want to do things to our cell tower.
Mm-hmm.
And it's possible that we could be getting more revenue from our cell tower. But, you know, unless you read all the fine print and you know what you're talking about and somebody knows what we get, how to manage these things, you know, we're sitting here saying, oh, I don't know. So we did ask Steve if he would consider doing that. He hasn't, I don't believe he's worked on it. And so I think he would check back in with us before we started. But that is something that we didn't talk to him about a year ago. So.
Okay. I think probably you need an authorized signature on this PDI.
This is the PDIP, right?
Yeah.
All right. So what this is doing, everyone.
You're just approving.
Is just, this. I'm approving that. We're removing Beverly Dion, who was our former treasurer. We're adding.
You're maintaining you.
Maintaining me.
In the
rear's
on the back. He's on the back. The next page.
Oh.
You're adding. Nope, the next one. Yeah, you're adding Burr.
Okay, contact information. I'm grocery treasurer.
So I think he has to sign it, though, as well, right? Right on the back, the third page again. It looks like he has to sign that box.
Yes, he will. So he'll need to sign this and date it.
So after you sign it, put it on.
So the permissions. I don't know why we're not adding Vern on that though. Well, I will sign this, but I'm going to ask Caroline to make sure Vern needs to be added. Contact must be previewed. No, I guess we're right. I guess that's it. He does get added. That's where he gets added. Okay. We're good. So, you know, in the past, if you looked at our on the revenue, if you looked at our interest earned line, you know, we've always been optimistic. I think it says like $500 and, you know, we get, what, $33.10. We're going to get like several thousands of dollars. I mean, I think we budgeted for it, but, you know, this was definitely more interest than we've made in quite a while. This is the. I'm gonna pass on this. It's too late and I'm in no condition. So I will try to read it next week.
Okay.
Or I'm in on Monday morning.
On the shipyard waste, we asked for them to give us more details.
Yes.
Change in charges due to market changes, $30 a ton, before of more than before need to calculate annual increase. We need to let the transfer station personnel and public know to keep only allowed items in recycling. Contaminated recycling equals fees.
So I think that was the paragraph.
I think that's what Caroline said. We're okay for just to have this.
Is this just an FYI for us?
I think so.
Oh, maybe this is the one that
we talked about this last week.
We talked about this, and we
needed more detail.
What the heck is this about? Okay, so she wrote that paragraph.
So that kind of.
Yeah, and like she said, public, if you're watching this, it's not like you have to wash your styrofoam Burger King thing. Just, you know, rinse it out and make sure that there isn't a lot of food residue.
So we just have a file?
Yes.
Okay, and then we have, this is to Suzanne, I think, something that feels like a steal.
Oh, okay, I think this is an FYI, but I've actually looked at this stuff online. And these are population trends. So we're holding pretty stable. Maybe slight increase over 2010. But, you know, really, you can look at this online, it's quite interesting. The age groups, you know, where the people fall.
So is this the census information that we all filled out?
It's, but it gets updated, but somehow dates are extracted from the most recent decennial U.S. Census.
So this U.S. Census?
That yeah, that's 2010, out. But they've got... So there must be some tool they use to interpolate or extrapolate or whatever the correct... word is, because we've got, you know, labor force issued information, property tax information, 2016 total housing units. So it's data other than just census data that they collect. It's fascinating to look at. But this is just an FYI file. Pardon? For the Department of Employment and Security, I think,
yeah,
which is also a funny place for it to come from. But, Sophia.
That is all I have.
Oh, bless you. Thank you. All right. Community input?
One quick question. Does the town hold any accounts or insurance through Eastern Bank? That's one of the questions. I said no, but I wanted to confirm the answer
is no. Our accounts are solely with Citizens Bank, and we opened up accounts with the New Hampshire Public Deposit in Esbit Cool, or whatever that is, the thing we call FIDA.
Okay.
And we're about to close those.
So I just wanted to confirm the information was correct.
We did also have a part-time, short-term loan from Connecticut.
Kennebunk.
Savings Bank. And we did talk, we did make contact with a person about having our, perhaps moving our accounts, because there's, you know, there's something nice about supporting local banks. I mean, you know, Citizen, you know, is in Rhode Island, but it's really like the Bank of Scotland, the Royal Bank of Scotland, or the Irish, or I don't know where. It's European, it's not local, so, but no Eastern, sorry.
Okay,
so that's good news. That helps them, they don't.
Anything else? All right. Are we adjourned, folks? Excellent.